When lame Dr. Donald Blake strikes his wooden walking stick upon the ground, it becomes the mystic mallet Mjolnir, and Blake is transformed into the Norse god of thunder, master of the storm and lightning, heir to the throne of immortal Asgard.
This is Comic Geek Speak, episode 1614. Spotlight on the mighty Thor in the Silver Age.
Across the rainbow bridge of Asgard, where the booming heavens roar, you behold in breathless wonder the god of thunder, mighty Thor.
Welcome to the show. I'm Brian Chrisman.
I'm Shane Kelly.
I be Adam Murdo.
And I'm Chris Eberle.
And somewhere from the other side of a rainbow bridge, Jamie D is smiling at us.
Oh, yes.
And once again, we come back to our Spotlight series at the helm of Mr. Eberle, this time talking about the mighty Thor in the Silver Age.
Aye.
Looking forward to this. Very much. Yeah, let's get that all out of the way. Oh, holy crap.
Oi.
Oh, great Odin's raven.
Old chestnut there we had from.
Where was that from?
That remember when we used to play with weird sexy bitches way back in the day?
Yeah. Yes.
They use that every now and then.
Mm-hmm. Fun with the soundboard in those days.
Say, what else am I going to get to use that?
Not that often, admittedly.
Anyway, well, before we get to out of the craziness here, or into the craziness, this episode of Comic Geek Speak is brought to you by SuperheroStuff.com. You can go to for all of your
superhero stuff.
Yes, for the geek lover in you or anyone you know, they are the place to go for anything related to geekdom. And of course, they have their Thor stuff. And a quick search shows up here. The first thing, Thor crew socks with capes.
Oh, nice.
Wow. Oh my God.
If you have hammer toes, it's perfect.
Oh, oh my God. They've got Thor throwing stickers. They've got, of course, many, many t-shirts, pants, cosmic art canvas. Wow, which looks like the Thor cover of issue 160 with Galactus, which we'll get to later in this episode.
And now, Galactus.
Thor hammer wristband. They've got buttons, of course, of the classic Thor and the new Lady Thor as well. Blankets, costumes for toddlers. Oh, just awesome stuff. Action figures for Thor, and of course, for almost any other geekdom, whether it's superheroes, science fiction, you know, Doctor Who, X-Files, Star Trek, Star Wars, you name it, they've got it. They're in the convention circuit this year. They were just down at SuperCon in Florida.
Nice.
Not too long ago. They were also, I believe, out in Denver. So check them out. SuperheroStuff.com. You go to for all of your
superhero stuff.
I have a pair of Batman socks with capes. They're fantastical.
Nice.
And Shane, one of my things I missed about you, because I haven't seen you in a while, is your use of the word fantastic. Copyright Shane.
That's one of my favorite made-up words.
Outstanding. Sorry, Pants, go ahead.
No, that's all right. And one more announcement, if you will, before we get too far along the spotlight. I mentioned a little while ago that this September 5th of 2016, we're going to be doing a 50th birthday episode for Jamie D. And we're soliciting listeners to call in. To give their thoughts or their favorite Jamie D memories or what have you, or favorite clips. Because I've gotten quite a lot of like emails or messages, but not too many voicemails. So we'll have you guys just call in, give us your thoughts. The number, oh boy.
I wasn't ready for that either, man. It's been a month. Holy smokes.
Be prepared for the voicemail number, but if you just bear with me 1 second here, I will bring that up here. The number is 267.
Oh,
702-6642. You can call in and leave a message as well. So we encourage you to do that. We're going to have a nice episode remembering Jamie on his 50th birthday this year.
It's a wonderful idea, Pants.
Yes. And again, like September 5th of 2016. All right. Well, the spotlight falls on Thor, and I turn it over to you, Mr. Eberle, with your wonderful outline as always.
Honored, brother. Honored.
Yeah, just make sure you talk into the microphone.
Yes,
don't turn your mouth.
I am going to, I don't want to get too tawdry here, but I'm going to swallow the microphone essentially.
That could be awkward.
All right, now, I was thinking about what spotlights I want to do over the summer because I have more free time because school's out of session, thank the stars. And I thought, you know, I've always loved Thor, the Marvel version of Thor. And we talked about him when we did our Avengers spotlights, for example. And he comes up in various other conversations we've had. But he's never been received the spotlight treatment. You guys didn't do it when you did your first run of spotlights years ago, did you?
I don't think we even did Thor at that point. No.
So
to the archives, says I.
Who's counting pantaloons? So I thought, you know what? I love the character, having the spotlight of him. I love the Kirby era of Thor, especially getting into the real cosmic stuff, the latter part of that run, which I know Murda's also dying to discuss. So I thought, what the hell? Let's spend some time with old Goldilocks. And I've spent the past, you know, week or so preparing. I'm really looking forward to this. And we mentioned JVD before. How would he mispronounce Mjolnir?
Mjolnir?
Fantastic.
Even when confronted with the more acceptable spellings, he would just, what's that, Mjolnir? He used the old man defense, and you know what? It worked for him every time.
God, I miss that prideful defiance. Outstanding. Yeah. So what we're going to be looking at here is going after we get into our initial reflections is Thor in the Silver Age. I should say the mighty Thor, because when we talk about Thor, and Murda's shaking his head in an annoying fashion.
What? Okay. Yeah. I thought you said in an annoying fashion.
No. That's what I thought. Oh,
annoying
so.
Fashion. Murda, yes.
Simply impossible.
Nodding sagely over here.
Indeed.
Yeah, that dumbass Chris, he's going to say something right now. That's, yeah, I know he was going for that.
Shaneroo. So, obviously, Thor is from ancient Norse mythology, so we're not really talking about that Thor, per se. We're talking about the Marvel version of Thor, which incorporates elements, obviously, of Norse mythology, which is then interwoven into the Marvel Universe. So I'm not an expert on the Thor of Norse mythology. I mean, I know some of the basics, but that's not really what we're going to be talking about, although that'll inevitably seep into this episode, because Kirby especially brought in elements of Norse mythology, especially through the classic Tales of Asgard backup stories that I'll be talking about as part of this spotlight episode. So we'll be focusing on Thor and the Silver Age, and that means we're focusing on primarily Stan Lee and Jack Kirby's take on the mighty Thor. So we're looking at issues from Journey to Mystery 83, which is Thor's first appearance.
Cover dated August of 1962, I believe.
Yippers.
Yes.
That was sexy.
Wow.
Well done.
Doesn't take much, does it? Good night, everybody.
It's summertime.
We're going to go through issue 179, which is Kirby's final pencils on Thor before he strikes the tent and makes the trek over to the Distinguished Competition.
Yeah, Thor 179, cover dated August of 1970. Comic book DB at my fingertips.
Excellent. And there's so many other things at your fingertips, too. Anyway, now.
I was not even born yet in 1970.
All right, so that's sort of the scope of this episode. But of course, when we get there, I'd love to hear everybody's initial impressions, sort of their first exposure to Thor, what made them aware of the character for the first time. Let's start with the Mighty Murdo.
Well, I guess the first time I became aware that there was a Marvel Comics version of the legendary God of Thunder was, well, it's about the same as my first exposure to a lot of other comics characters. Matt. You know, CGS Matt just showed me his Marvel Universe trading cards, and so I remember seeing a version of his first appearance. You know, the Journey into Mystery number 82 covers a part of that 1962, and yes, I think there was a card for his rivalry with Ulick in that series as well. But then shortly after, I mean, I think maybe what made Thor seem even realer to me as a character though was when I actually came within a foot or two of his first appearance shortly after that. Like one of my first forays out to the Renninger's antique market, flea market, in Adamstown, Pennsylvania. Dealer there was, my dad was chatting with him, and he dug out and showed me a copy of Journey into Mystery number 83.
Wow.
Yep, with at that point it probably would have been semi-affordable,
yeah.
Too.
Yeah, I'd say so.
I mean, not for like a 13-year-old's budget, but still, I saw with my own eyes a copy of Thor versus the Stone Men of Saturn swinging that mighty hammer around on that rooftop, and that it dazzled me a little bit. You know, the thought that this being from mythology was just walking the rooftops of Manhattan in this alternate reality that is the Marvel Universe, and of course I didn't know the half of the grand cosmic saga that was the life story of Marvel's mighty Thor, but that was, you know, my first inkling. having seen that. And I also saw that same cover image in a price guide shortly thereafter.
Shaney Poo?
That's a better origin story for Thor than mine. I'm pretty sure mine would have been, either on, if he was on ever, Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends, or at the very least, those Lou Ferrigno,
the TV movies? Bixby.
Bill Bixby. Good heavens, TV movies, yeah. That would have been my next first closest association with Thor.
That's probably the first live-action representation of Thor.
Yeah, I would think. I'd have to figure out years for those movies, but I don't think I was getting comics when they were coming out. But I was watching the TV shows and things that came on. Probably reading him would have been the Avengers series with George Perez and it was after Heroes Were Born, I think.
Oh, Busiek.
Busiek.
Oh, it's a classic.
That probably was my first time reading Thor with any regularity. And then when Straczynski came on, I read that whole
tremendous
series.
Run.
That was an absolutely fantastic run. But I didn't read much Thor up until that point. If he guest starred or showed up in an issue here and there throughout Marvel stuff I was reading through Spider-Man back in the late 80s and 90s, maybe, but it wasn't until that Avengers series that I really started to read any kind of Thor. And then picked up the Mighty Thor when that came out and some other stuff. But Straczynski's run was probably my favorite so far that I've read.
Mighty Trouser?
For me, the first memory I have of Thor is the Mego figure of Thor. Because I had all of the superhero Marvel figures, or Mego figures, Marvel and DC at the time. And what I remember about Thor's figure the most is, and I mentioned this much before, I think we had our toy talk, Shane, is on Thor's head, it had a hole bored into his head so he could put his winged helmet on, because his winged helmet had a little protrusion come out from the middle so it could stay on his head. Mm-hmm. And just bore right into his head. I thought that was so cool. So that's the first recollection I have of Thor. But you brought along there the, take the cover off, what's that, the Origin of Marvel yes. Comics. I had that as a child, so I'm probably also going to remember this. Now, this, I'm sure it had Journey Mystery 83, but
yes,
what was the other issue?
Thor 143.
That's the other one that I remember in there with the Enchantress. So that's how I sort of got first exposed to that. But I don't think, I might have picked up one or two comics when I was a kid in the 70s. Didn't get into Thor at all because I was blind to Marvel for most of the 90s and so forth. The first time I can actually remember being jazzed about a Thor title, I actually mentioned this on the air, at the Baltimore Comic Con in September of 2012 when they had the Marvel Now initiative, I was curious about it. So I went to a panel there hosted by Tom Brevoort and Mark Waid, where just before they were actually going to come out, they had like some copies of these first issues, and they had a photocopy of Thor number one with Jason Aaron and Asad Ribic. And if you answered a question, you actually go up on the panel and read the issue before it came out. And they asked the question, what was Thor's first appearance? And so it's a Journey of Mystery. And they said, what issue? And I said under my breath to myself, 83. And Mark White goes, who said that? I'm like in like second row. And I said, I did. Come on. So I got called up. I got called up on stage and read that issue. Of course, it was only black and white, right there on the panel, and gave my impression of it right away. And I loved it. And so I got the rest of the Thor issues that came out, and I've been getting Thor ever since, including its current incarnation with the Lady Thor. And I really, really love Jason Aaron from Exalted for me.
Oh, he's.
And of course, the art by Asad Ribic was no slouch either.
Aaron's doing a great take on Thor, both the male and the female versions of the character. Yeah.
But what little I remember of the early stuff is, who the hell is Donald Blake? he boom. So we're going to get into that.
No, Pants, I'm glad you brought that up, because one of the things we're going to talk about in this episode, I'm sorry to mean to cut
you off.
No,
that's
there,
fine.
Is that a lot of people who come to Thor later on or through the movies probably have no clue who Donald Blake mm-hmm. is.
Yeah.
Because
he's only mentioned once in a movie.
As like a throwaway gag for
yeah,
long time
yeah, like
readers.
The ID
because
card
uh-huh,
yeah.
of her
Donald
ex-boyfriend.
Blake, that persona has basically no role in Thor's current storylines. Yeah. And going back some years now, actually.
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about in this episode who Donald Blake is and what crucial role he played. And what, and I should say, what Donald Blake is. Because he's not...
Hmm.
He's not
calling
really,
me intrigued because I don't remember much about
well,
this.
Well, he's not really fully a man or a human being, per se. Murd probably knows what I'm talking about.
Mm. He's a tribble.
So we'll, a tribble. So we'll get into all that, but I'm glad you brought that up, Pansy.
He's three ducks in a doctor costume.
Don't you love how Pants is kind of like the Zelig of the comic book world? Like, he just pops up in all these key moments and like modern goings on in the comic book world. Fantastic.
There, I'm sure there's a drawing out there of him with a big wave. Hey! Pants shirt, pants hat.
I have the pants hat on right now.
I know
my
you
hair,
do.
Well, my hair's all messy.
They can see it.
No, they can't. Oh, yeah, they can't.
Yes, they can. Boom!
I forgot. Video! I forgot. Oh, amazing video.
I'm sorry, Pansy, finish your introduction.
I think that was about it. But like I said, I'm reading the Thor right now and looking forward to discussing his Silver Age adventures.
Terrific, Pantaloons.
Yes.
Now, for me, I've loved the Thor character since I basically could read. And I'll go back to one of my often told comic origin stories. My beloved cousins, who were a couple years older than me, they had a pile of comics from the Bronze Age that they sort of passed on to me in, let's say, the late 70s or early 1980s. And in them, among that pile, was a copy of Thor issue 213, which is a Bronze Age issue. The title is The Demon Brigade. And it was the first time, this is the thing, I think even before I read Origin of Marvel Comics, I hadn't even read Journey into Mystery 83 yet. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, I'd heard of Thor. I'd seen him, like he was on my lunchbox I had. Like, I had the metal.
Oh, I had the lunchbox as well, yes.
I had the metal lunchbox from the 70s, man, that had Thor on it. So I knew who Thor was. But I just, there's a superhero. He looks kind of like a Viking. He's named Thor. I didn't know anything about Norse mythology. I was a little kid and so forth. So I get this comic, like, oh, there's this character, Thor. Read it, loved it. I still have it in my own version of the Diefenbach collection at home. that issue, the cover was by Jim Starlin. Listen to this. These heavy hitters. Writers were Conway and Len Wein. Pencils, John Buscema, Don Perlin. Inks, Vince Coletta.
Wow.
So, 1973, early Bronze, early Thor issue from the Bronze Age. Let me read you a quote from that story because it's so, I think, captures the grand hyperbole of the world of Thor. This is Thor speaking. Thy minions that merely annoy me, treacherous one. Now nothing doth stand between us save the battle and the glory. And even at my young age, I was taken by just this over-the-top, grandiose language. And of course, we're going to talk about how Stan Lee will insert this sort of pseudo-Elizabethan dialogue, these speech patterns into Thor, which are not there initially in the first issues of Thor. They kind of creep in as the title develops. But I just love the world. Like, this issue had, like, the Warriors 3 in it, so I got to see it, met them right away. I don't remember if Sif was in it or not. And I remember in the story, Odin, something happened to Odin where he was actually craven and callow. And, like, Thor's almost ashamed of him. So that was my first experience of Odin. I didn't realize, we'll talk about this, how much of a dick Odin actually is. And it was funny, as I was preparing my checklist, just in the Silver Age, the amount of times Odin is, like, the worst father you can possibly imagine. Over and over and over again. It's to the point where I was laughing out loud preparing these notes because it just got hilarious how many times Odin just intervenes in Thor's life in a disastrous fashion. Basically, including one, I don't know if you, I thought of you, Shane, you get a kick out of this. There's one issue we'll talk about where Dr. Strange needs an operation. This is in the Silver Age. And Donald Blake is one of the world's greatest surgeons.
Sure.
So he's trying to save Dr. Strange, and Odin is pissed that Thor has taken up the cause of Midgard over Asgard. So he knocks out the electricity in the hospital while Donald Blake is doing the surgery on Dr. Strange. So we're also going to talk about just Odin and his temper tantrums, which are just such a really entertaining aspect of Thor's Silver Age history, essentially. But when I first introduced to Odin this Bronze Age issue, I had no sense of that yet.
Yeah.
And then after that, I got Origins of Marvel Comics. And Shane, I think you have the image of Journey Mr. 83 up there.
Absolutely.
And so then I read The Origin of Thor. And I remember I was struck how the costume was very similar. Like it wasn't tweaked that much from his first appearance to when I read this Bronze Age issue. But, you know, the language was different, and it read more like kind of a normal guy who just found out, oh, I have the power of Thor. And we'll get into more why that changes over time. And then I read in that same Origins of Marvel Comics, as many of you know, the Fireside Editions, this whole series of books that I treasure. Fireside hired Stan Lee to write these remembrances on the his version, of course, on the beginning of the Marvel Universe in the 60s. And each book, Origins of Marvel Comics, Son of Origins of Marvel Comics, Bring on the Bad Guys, which has the origin of Loki in it, for example. And is it this? I think it's called The Superhero Women. And they did some other books that just focused on particular characters. Would have two reprints in it, the origin and then a subsequent issue to show the character had evolved and developed. And in the early 80s, since there weren't really much in the way of trade paperbacks yet, these books were always exciting to get your hands on one of them. Yeah. And they were in print for quite some time. Mm-hmm. So the second feature was Thor 143, when the book transitioned from Journey into Mystery to the Mighty Thor masthead. And I remember as a kid being floored by the fact that it opens with Thor at a soda fountain ordering what looks like the world's most delicious soda, while a bunch of you know, 1960s youth are gathered around him just in awe, and Thor talks about, I need to slake my thirst and so forth. And right away, I was automatically besotted with the Marvel Universe.
Yeah, Shane pulled the image up right now.
And how it approaches superheroes. And between what I read in issue 213, the Origins of Marvel Comics, that began my lifelong love for Marvel's version of the character of Thor. And I've read the title ever since. I started reading it regularly in the 1980s. Unfortunately, I started reading it after the Simonson run on a monthly basis. But I've read much of the Simonson run going back. But from the 80s forward, latter 80s forward, I've never missed an issue of Thor. Basically.
So you were there for the whole Tom DeFalco run, then.
I know you're a big fan of Tom DeFalco, Murd.
His Thor stuff is better than some of the
okay,
other things
fair enough.
He's done.
Yeah, I read all that. And I agree with Shane. The Straczynski run is one of my favorite periods
that,
in all
that
of
was
Thor's
out of this world.
Publishing history. And perhaps we'll get to that in a future episode.
Yeah.
But I was thinking, like, my God, I loved it in the spotlights. I haven't talked about Thor yet. I love Thor. So I'm thrilled to be here to be discussing what really is the formative era. I mean, when you think about the mighty Thor, you got to talk about Jack Kirby. because I think some of my favorite Kirby art from the Silver Age, the Marvel Silver Age, is in Thor.
Did I hear someone say Kirby art from the Silver Age?
Fire away, honeybee. I'm counting on this.
So I was doing a little research, and I remember that from Journey into Mystery 83, Thor's first appearance, I believe it's the eighth story page with Thor when he has the hammer and is throwing it. It goes through a tree and it comes back to him. He thumps it on the ground. It's summoning rain or snow and lightning. It's a 9-panel page, and anything from like first appearances like this, it's an historical page. This page actually was up for auction about 6 years ago. August of 2010. And 6 years ago, that page went for $65,000. A 9-panel page of Thor with Kirby. Granted, it's his first appearance. I'm just amazed this damn thing still exists and was out there in the public eye. If that went up for auction today, good gosh, I might speculate about that. But I have a high-resolution image I can look at as whenever I want here. That's amazing. That's what I love about the Heritage Archives.
Well, Pants, I was counting on that original art input from you because early, I mean, how common is early Kirby original art like that? That's early Marvel age.
Well, you know, again, this is in 1962.
Yeah.
My knowledge of...
And Sinnott was the inker, right? I believe he was.
Well, let's see.
Yes, he was. Yes. Yeah. Journey into Mystery number 83. Yeah.
I mean, there's early Hulk pages that I know are out there. I think Hulk 3. There's X-Men 2 pages I've seen. I think X-Men 1 pages, which knocks me out that this stuff is still around. It's out there.
Right.
People want, you can actually see it. It's not buried away in someone's black hole collection.
Especially from back then when so many things were just tossed aside and thrown out, just like people cleaning out closets
and
throwing away holes.
Cut them up and use them as backer boards to draw on.
Yeah.
And you never know where some of this stuff ends up. Recently, if I can figure out which cover it was, there was a Thor Silver Age cover by Jack Kirby that recently appeared in an auction in London for like in a toy catalog. So all this toys, and here's a Hulk. I mean, here's a Thor cover from Jack Kirby in the auction. disappeared out of nowhere. This woman had it, didn't want to sell, you know, out of the country, just put it at the auction house, and boom, it went for like, again, like $60,000.
Wow. Well, didn't you tell me that from the same era, isn't Amazing Fantasy 15 in the Library of Congress?
The original art is the whole, in the Library of Congress, right?
The whole story.
Yep.
Get out.
That's some...
So you can go and request to see it then.
Yeah, I have to make an appointment.
Right.
But someday we should do that.
We should do that.
That is a great idea.
That is a great
idea. Holy crap. I mean, I'm going to have to jot that down.
Definitely.
Somebody else keep talking.
Put that down for a summer outing. That's a great idea.
Now you see like the word balloon with the light bulb appearing over Pansy's head, essentially.
Mr. Christman goes to Washington.
Road trip.
All right. Anyway, enough about me. Let's talk about Thor.
All right.
Well, I had a question for
Chris.
Please,
sir. Please.
So when you read the titles, like read one of the titles of an issue you just did, the way you do.
In the Blaze of Battle.
Do you do that when you and Keiko go to sit down and watch Friends, the one with the embryos? Or is that just specific to...
Anytime, as you all know, my wife is a master at and ridiculing me, and deservedly so. And anytime I descend into melodramatic, self-deprecating hyperbole, which of course I do on purpose, she either rolls her eyes or just, you know, totally puts me down as only she can. And you've seen this in a
we've participated,
yes, as you should, in a loving but let's say a lovingly harsh manner.
You could say extremely harsh, it's okay.
Yeah, she'll call me like dork or twit or, you know, other you know, unmentionables, for example. But it's, look, anyone as geeky as I am, I would never take myself too seriously, and I have to laugh at myself, because if I didn't, as you all know, I'd be in a straitjacket somewhere by this point.
You and me both.
So, yeah. So it's how she, one of the many, it's how she expresses her love and her tolerance for my ridiculous hobbies and passions. Speaking of hobbies and passions, let's talk about the Mighty Thor.
Let's.
Now, I thought we'd start talking a bit about Thor's origin, which is very interesting, and his power set. Now, as we mentioned, his first appearance is in Journey to Mystery 83, August 1962. And some listeners may not be aware that Stanley didn't actually write the script to Journey to Mystery 83. He came up with the plot. Larry Lieber, his younger brother, who's also still living, actually wrote the script, and of course Kirby and Sinnott contributed the art. Now, again, we should quickly recap the Marvel method. So, Lee, at this point, they'd already created, let's see, the Fantastic Four, the Hulk. I don't know if they'd done Spider-Man yet or not.
It was around the same
time. Spider-Man came out in 1962 in Amazing Fantasy. So, around the same time, and Lee, as part of the Marvel method, because he was editor-in-chief, he was art director, he was wearing so many different hats, he would often write quick plots and then hand them off to the artist, which of course leads to a lot of the creator controversy decades later. But he also started to have his brother Larry, who was an able penciler and scripter, to script some of these stories. So Larry Lieber has a hand in the first appearance of the Mighty Thor. Now, basically, if you've read or seen interviews with Stan Lee, he talks about Thor, he always kind of sticks to the same line, which is that he was trying to think of a hero that was new and interesting and even more powerful than any hero they conceived so far, perhaps even more powerful than the Hulk. And he thought, well, what about a god? And he realized, of course, well, I can't write a comic about God, because that obviously would cause all kinds of headaches and controversies, and, you know, who the hell am I? So he referred to various mythologies that thought, well, everybody knows the Greek and Roman gods. People are not as well versed in the Norse gods. Let's go with Thor. Now, I have to mention here, as you read The Mighty Thor in the Silver Age, I think it's very clear that Kirby had enormous input in Thor's world, because Kirby was very well versed in mythology, probably more so than Lee. That's just an educated guess on my part. So, once again, we always have to have the caveat out there in that I never want to say Stan Lee created the Mighty Thor, because there's no way he did it on his own, because the Marvel method precluded that. This is clearly a collaboration, and he very well may have had the initial idea, as he did, I think he did for many of these characters, but as Thor develops, Kirby's input is enormous, I think especially so with this character. fact, I'm going to read a quote from Kirby as when he was interviewed about Thor. He says here, "I began to realize what a wonderful and awesome place the universe is. And that helped me in comics because I was looking for the awesome. I found it in Thor." And he says here, another clip, "The truth is that the Greeks had Hercules, even as the Norsemen had Thor. And through the ages, we've had heroes similar to them in ages past. We had Samson, who's no more than a superhero. And today we have our superheroes. We believe in them because we believe in ourselves." I love that Kirby optimism, right? That sort of tapping into like the grandeur of the cosmos and our place in it, essentially. Now here's a quote from Lee about, you know, the genesis of Thor. "Ever since man has walked the earth, there have been legends of gods and their goddesses, their problems, their battles, their triumphs, and their defeats. Okay. Since we were the legend makers of today, we'd simply take what had gone before, build on it, embellish it, and come up with our own version of the continuing saga of good versus evil, god-wise, that is." Vintage Stan Lee right there. He also wrote, "I chose the Norse gods because I felt people were less familiar with them than with the Greek and Roman gods." So I think those quotes emphasize, as much as we can sort of connect the dots, the role both men played in breathing life into their version of the mythos of Thor, because we established Thor is a long-established mythological figure. And this is Marvel's spin on that concept. So both men obviously played their part, and especially we're going to talk about as we move forward, especially the role Kirby played in creating this grand cosmic opera, all right, when it came to Thor, almost, you know, Wagnerian lengths here, essentially. Now, in terms of Thor's origins, in terms of the story itself, we have to remember that Thor is not fully Asgardian. Murray, do you know what I mean by that?
I do.
Please, elaborate.
He is a rare Asgardian hybrid. Mm. His mother is actually not Frigg or Frigga, the wife of Odin. Mm. His mother is a goddess of a different pantheon, described by some sources as an elder goddess, actually. Mm. Described as Yord by the Asgardians and Gaia by others. So she is like this patron goddess of the earth, actually more ancient than either the Asgardians or the Olympians, the gods of Greece, which is a part of the essential tie of Thor to the planet Earth, why he seems to keep coming back there, and why he feels such a kinship with its people, and why he feels so driven to defend it, sometimes at the cost of his allegiance to Asgard itself. It's also, what makes him stronger than just about any other Asgardian,
right,
except perhaps the Allfather himself, his link with the Earth. So it's kind of similar to the Superman mythos in that respect. The Earth is what made him Superman. Krypton may have made him part of what he is, but only by coming to Earth to its yellow sun did he gain the power to become the champion for good throughout the universe that he became. So it's the fact that Earth is a part of Thor's mixed heritage that makes him the champion that he is.
Once again, I got that tingle that started at the base of my spine, went all the way up, almost like through chakras.
I've got pills for that, I hear.
Fantastic, Murd. I was counting on
now
that.
Now you know how we feel listening to you hold forth for hours on end, Chris.
Well, I'm glad you stay awake at least. Now, Murd, I'm glad you brought that up because you got to question Odin here because, all right, so you go out of your way to mate with basically the matriarchal goddess of Earth, like she's like the personification of Earth's life force, I guess you would say. Yet you get ticked when your son feels he keeps needing to return to Midgard, as Earth is called. We're going to talk a lot about Odin and his temper tantrums throughout this episode here, because I find Odin particularly fascinating as he's interpreted by Lee and Kirby and others in the Silver Age.
So his rage over Thor's behavior is just kind of like the consequence of a cosmic custody battle, you might say? Spending too much time with his mother?
That's one way of looking at it, I suppose, my friend, indeed. Now, in terms of that strength, as you mentioned, Thor is, in the Marvel Universe, one of the strongest beings in the Marvel Universe in terms of strength, resiliency, speed, ability to heal, senses. I mean, he's virtually invulnerable. And, of course, one of the old timeless questions is, who is stronger, Thor or the Hulk? And we'll talk about an issue we get into our checklist where actually some in the comic, some kids on the street ask Thor, are you stronger than the Hulk? And he actually recounts with them a tale from the past where he actually met the Hulk in battle. Of course, the end result is inconclusive. And I think they fight again in the Defenders. I want to say Defenders issue 10.
I think I just read that, actually, just as we were driving down to HeroesCon the other week, Pants and I. Yeah, it was
Time Bubble.
Steve Englehart written Avengers Defenders. It was packaged.
The Avengers Defenders War.
Clash.
Yeah.
They called it a Clash at the time, but then they repackaged it as War.
Right.
I bought the trade at your store, actually, at Wild Pig Comics
in
Kenilworth, New Jersey. And it was a crossover in the summer of 1973, and there was indeed a Hulk Thor Clash as a part of that story. And it ended, naturally, in a stalemate.
Of course. So. I guess it's a matter of which character you favor in terms of who do you think is stronger. Now, as an example of this strength, Thor can survive in virtually any environment. You often see him, careening through outer space. He's not wearing a breathing apparatus or anything like that. He can also survive in virtually any dimension. As we're going to discuss, his hammer has the power to pierce dimensional barriers, so he can go into different dimensions as well as through time and space. So this is a huge, heavy hitter in the Marvel Universe. And as Murd mentioned, he is stronger than all the Asgardians, with the possible exception of the All-Father Odin himself, because of his unique parentage, both the Lord of Asgard and essentially the matriarchal Lord of Earth's very life essence. So a unique powers, to say the least. Now, we should also mention, though, and this is a bit of a retcon. The Asgardians are not immortal. They age at a dramatically slower rate than human beings on Earth. So they live for thousands of years. And they really emphasize this in the movies, actually.
Yeah, they do.
But when you read these original comics, when they first are coming out, you just assume, well, these are the gods of Asgard and they're immortal.
Now that aging, is that due to a fruit that they mentioned in the movie that they eat to slow down their
yes,
aging?
Yes, that's
the apples from the Garden of Eden.
Okay.
Idunn, which is actually the name of a goddess who is the guardian of those apples.
And that's right. That also helps sort of retard their age, essentially. But they're not truly immortal. They don't live forever. Odin has a father. Bor, I believe his name was.
Right,
and there was who was the grandfather? Burr or?
Bori?
Bori.
Yes,
that's right.
B-U-R-I,
so
yeah.
there's an ancestry here. So they can die, per se. And they can be injured. They can't. Oh, that's very difficult. They can be killed. And they need sustenance, as, of course, Volstagg very much indulges in, as we discuss, and so forth. So they're now, obviously, the way that they've kind of, I think it's a very clever approach, and they even explain this in the original movie, and they've also done so in the comics, that, well, to the ancient Vikings, or the ancient Germanic tribes, they seem like gods.
Sure.
So they worship them as gods, and Thor and other Asgardians encouraged that worship. Again, I should reemphasize for our listeners, I'm just talking about the Thor of the Marvel Universe here. We're not getting into the sheer pageantry of the Norse myths of Thor, though many of them do seep into this, of course.
No. Yeah.
In many ways.
Does the age thing also filter down to like Jotunheim and the other worlds of Asgard area? Like all the things they control?
Like the elves, the dwarves,
yeah,
and
do
so
they
forth?
All last forever and ever?
I'm not
ever?
Sure about that.
Longer lived than Earth humans, certainly. Okay. But not to the extent of the residents of the Shining Realm itself.
Okay. The Shining Realm.
Yes.
Fantastic.
But, just to dip briefly, though, into actual mythology.
Please,
though,
sir. I'm counting on that.
This idea of the Asgardians being a more mortal or race or limited lifespan race of gods than certain other pantheons sort of comes from, the ancient Norse or Teutonic outlook of life, too, because those, even in the ancient myths, those Norse gods were portrayed as mortal, as slayable. In fact, the characters died in those myths fairly often, and there is, of course, the terminal myth of Ragnarok, which shows all of the gods, the twilight of the gods, all of the gods and the universe itself dying and then being reborn.
Which Kirby played into heavily throughout Thor.
Oh yes, Ragnarok has been an oft-recurring theme in the Marvel version of the Norse mythos. This idea of Asgardian deities as being mortal, that does have some roots in the traditional myths. And if you read the official handbook of the Marvel Universe, every entry for an Asgardian character goes out of its way to say that Asgardians are not true immortals in the way that Olympians are. And then it cross-references you to the Olympians, because they are, the Greeks had a different view of their pantheon, their deities. So they are closer to the deathless, eternal figures of myth, whereas the Asgardians are more reflections of the more I don't know, fatalistic worldview of the culture that gave rise to them.
Absolutely outstanding, Murd. In fact, we're going to talk about the Olympians because they will end up in some of the Thor stories in the Silver Age as well.
Oh, you betcha.
In fact, we should mention that Thor, we've talked about his strength. He's stalemated the Hulk. He's stalemated the Juggernaut. And Hercules, son of Zeus, who is also a pretty prominent supporting character in some of Thor's Silver Age adventures, including one of the probably one of the most famous covers of the Thor Silver Age, which I believe is Thor issue 126, when it switches over from Journey into Mystery to the mighty Thor masthead. In fact, I was reading in the back where that Thor apparently felled Namor one time with one punch, so which probably Submariner deserved, no doubt. So this is one of the most powerful entities in the Marvel Universe, without question. Now, if you're going to talk about the power of Thor, you have to talk about the hammer. Now, Murd, the pronunciation again, please.
Well, there's some variation there.
I always say Mjolnir. That's
say it again?
Mjolnir.
More like Mjolnir.
Okay.
Although, you say it better than I do. I always said Mjolnir. And actually, when we were doing footnotes on the Simonson run of Thor, we actually did find a letters page in which Walt Simonson himself said that he pronounced it Mjolnir.
Mjolnir, okay.
But there's Mjolnir is certainly, there's some justification for pronouncing it that way, too.
Or what, Mew Mew, I guess?
Mew Mew.
If you're Kat Denning, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, or Mjolnir if you're Jamie.
Now, it translates into apparently that which smashes. That's got to be a Scandinavian language, right?
Well, surely.
Yeah. I'm not sure which one, to be honest with you.
Don't call me Shirley. I just watched Airplane the other night.
Me too.
You're glad they're here, aren't you?
You know me well, brother. You took the words right out of my mouth. I can start on an airplane tangent. I won't, because every scene is a gem. I just thought of the nun slapping the woman in the face. Moving on. Now, of course, the inscription. Whosoever holds this hammer, if he be worthy, shall possess the power of Thor. And actually, Shane, if you go to the origin page. God, that was sexy.
Boom. Already up.
Now,
it's already up, baby.
Efficiency.
Now, apparently Larry Lieber created the term Uru metal, which Stanley says Lieber just made up, essentially. So less of this mystical metal. The hammer. Now, the hammer, of course, was forged from the core of a star. And Odin, or the dwarves of, I'm probably going to butcher this, it's one of the nine realms. You want to try it, Murd? Go ahead.
Nidavellir.
I'm so glad he said it.
The dwarves' names, or Nidavellir, depending on how you want to pronounce that IR suffix. But the dwarves' names were Brock and Eitri, incidentally.
Okay.
Magnificent. Or as Volstagg would say, zounds. Now... So forged from the core of a star, of course, Odin enchanted it. And you remember in the film, when he speaks the inscription, you see them blazoned on the side of the mallet, essentially. And Mjolnir, it's essentially indestructible. It's probably one of the most powerful weapons in the Marvel Universe. It really can't be destroyed in any way, shape, or form. And I should emphasize that it is not the source of Thor's power. Thor himself is the power, but he channels a lot of his powers through the hammer, like flight and creating vortexes through time or through barriers or shooting energy blasts or creating shields. It all comes through him, but channeled through Mjolnir, essentially.
That's his conduit out.
Well put, sir. Now, we should mention, only a handful of beings in the history of the comic have been able to actually lift the hammer besides Thor. Murd, do you want to take a stab at that?
Well, it's right here on this.
Yeah, I'd like to hear in your sonorous tones.
Okay. The words of Chris Epperly. Only Thor, Red Norvell.
Okay, who is Red Norvell? I'm sorry.
Red Norvell is an Earthman.
Darren's cousin.
What?
Long red hair and a beard. He was like a substitute Thor in the 90s, and not 90s, 70s. And was he a criminal?
I'm trying to recall. I dimly recall him.
I have his first appearance, but I don't remember his backstory.
I'm sorry,
right?
I just never heard that name before.
He looks a lot more like the depiction of Thor, descriptions of Thor from the old myths, big and burly and bearded, and he has like a horned helmet when he becomes Thor.
Okay.
And he's a rough, tough Ben Grimm kind of guy, and okay. he proves himself worthy of becoming a surrogate Thor for a time, and he's popped up in the Thor comics from time to time over the decades. Then there's also Buri, who was Thor's grandfather. Great-grandfather. And Bor, who is Thor's grandfather, Odin's father.
And Bor is mentioned in the Dark World.
Oh, he is.
Yes, he is.
The second Thor film, yeah.
Yep.
Then Odin himself, Beta Ray Bill, the alien, and Captain America. Those are the ones that are listed
and,
here.
And I see you didn't mention Superman here.
What's that?
From JLA Adventures number 4, the cover.
Oh, God. I didn't even remember that one.
Oh, and there was a Wonder Woman, too. Didn't she pick up the...
I don't know. I'm just looking at the cover image. That's the only thing I pulled up by news.
I'm pretty sure I remember that Wonder Woman in the DC versus Marvel miniseries did pick up the hammer, and there was kind of like a cliffhanger. Will she use it as an unfair advantage against Storm or not?
Okay.
And so that was one of the worst characterization faux pas in that miniseries, I think, because it could have gone either direction, and it was the voting of the... readers that determined what her decision would be, and ultimately she decided, no, not even to save my universe can I take unfair advantage of an opponent, and she throws the hammer aside, and then Storm kicks her ass.
Storm beat Wonder Woman?
But yes, by the will of the readers, yes.
Okay. I forgot about that whole deal. I mean, I don't remember, but I don't remember that particular battle, but I think that's ridiculous. But anyway...
Kind of think of it. Didn't Storm actually wield Mjolnir during... I'm thinking of those stories in the 80s when the X-Men and the New Mutants traveled to Asgard. Or is that a what-if I'm thinking of?
Well, wait a minute, Murd. You may be honest in that. There's a famous cover. It's one of the X-Men annuals where Storm is like almost like the goddess of thunder. Those are good stories. Those are Art Adams artwork. There's the New Mutants special, and then there's the X-Men annual. They crossed over. Possibly. But I see Pants is looking that up right now. What I wanted to mention, though, is that I love how in Avengers 2, when they're having that playful scene in Stark Tower, and they're all trying to pick up the hammer.
Okay, this is the movie we're talking about.
Yes,
this is the movie.
And Steve Rogers jostles it. You see the look of panic on Thor's face temporarily.
Because nobody else at that point.
Yeah. Now, this is a pure wish fulfillment guess on my part. I'm predicting. I want to see... In battle with Thanos, Steve Rogers has to pick up that hammer.
Oh, I think he will.
That's just, I'd love to see it.
I think at some point Thor will get knocked about or will have to toss it to Steve and he'll grab it and do something with it.
I don't want to pull down any further, but there are others.
Go for it. Let's hear it.
Okay. I pulled up an article on the interwebs. Awesome Andy.
Oh, okay. That's the... Mad Thinker's android. So that was probably done as a joke. But
see,
then again,
volume two,
non-living beings okay. have been... That's a loophole in Odin's enchantment. They can sometimes pick up the hammer.
Which explains Vision picking it up?
Yep. There's a what-if story where Conan lifts it.
Okay, I remember that what-if, yep.
In Avengers Assemble number 4, Hulk.
Interesting. That one I didn't know. Interesting.
Now look at this. There's the Ultimates where Magneto lifts it.
Really?
Red Hulk lifts it.
Oh, Red Hulk now?
It's what it says here. In Hulk Volume 2, number 5 from 2008. Of course, I mentioned Superman. Throg?
Throg?
So it's a scene in Lockjaw and the Pet Avengers, number 1.
Oh, okay. That's the frog. Thor.
The Thor frog, yeah.
Yeah, that's...
That's for Simonson.
Thunderstrike?
Questionable canonicity.
That's
Eric Masterson, yeah.
Okay,
so he merged with Thor for a
time. And you were correct, sir. Mr. Myrtle, Wonder Woman.
No Storm, though.
I don't see it listed here.
Okay.
Again, it's the interweb. Take it at your...
And, well, then there's also Jane Foster, but I guess that's kind of the same deal as with Eric Masterson.
True.
Yeah. Plus, Frigga kind of tampered with the enchantment a little bit, so...
Now...
Who hasn't lifted the hammer?
Like in the movies where they joke around about, well, it goes up in an elevator, but the elevator's not worthy. Is there ever any kind
it's
of...
It's a non-living being.
Is there ever, like, a banter of that in one of the issues anywhere in time? I mean, I know we're talking about the Silver Age, but...
Somewhere.
I'd like to read an issue where they banter about that somewhere.
Sounds like something Bendis would write.
That's what I'm thinking, but I don't remember.
I haven't read that, but that doesn't mean, of course, it doesn't mean it's not out there. So
if somebody
knows,
drop us a line on the...
I mean, I think in the scene in the film Avengers 2, that scene was so Joss Whedon. It was so perfectly written and just so in his wheelhouse, the way that scene, you know.
I mean, there's the one at the party and then at the end when they're leaving... the new Avengers base when they Tony, Steve, and Thor just bantering about that. Those are both great scenes. I love them.
Now, in terms of the power of Mjolnir, first of all, as I mentioned, it can pass through any barrier to return to its wielders. So if Thor throws the hammer, it has to come back. And Murd always tells the great story, I forgot the number, but I've read it, the Marvel team-up, where Spider-Man hangs on to the hammer as it flies back to Thor. He can't stop it, of course. He's just kind of clinging to it with his stick-em as it goes back to Thor's hand. Do you remember that?
Might have been Matt that told that story.
I thought you did.
I don't think I did. I remember it, but I don't think I'm the one who told it.
But I've read that issue, too, and that's a lot of fun. Now, of course, one of the great plot devices of the Silver Age, we all know this. If Thor is separated from Mjolnir for more than 60 seconds, he reverts to his human persona of Donald Blake. Now, obviously, you can see that every Marvel character, especially in the Silver Age, has to have that Achilles heel, right? That weakness that can trip him up and make interesting stories. So we should note again, that's gone. You never hear about Thor. I mean, that's not. I mean, in fact, again, probably a lot of newer readers or watch the films have no clue what we're talking about, essentially, because that was phased out a long time ago. And we'll talk about why, because it also to do with what happened to Donald Blake, essentially. But very much in the Silver Age, for most of the Silver Age, that's a constant presence. That I can't let go of the hammer for more than 60 seconds. Like, you have scenes where Thor tries to hide in a crowd among people, like he's, you know, because Jane's going to see that I'm Thor, and or you know this and that. So,
oh, that whole chestnut.
So that it's a key plot device, in the Silver Age. But again, as I said, it's now defunct. Now, as I mentioned, Thor and Shane used the word conduit. Mjolnir is a conduit for Thor's powers. So, as we all mentioned, as Murray mentioned earlier, Thor is the god of thunder. So he has absolute control and mastery over the weather, which I would imagine, Murray, has to do with the fact that he's partially of Earth, is my guess there.
Makes good sense to me.
As well. Now, and he uses the hammer as sort of like to channel a lot of that power. You see classic images of Thor, you know, whirling Mjolnir above his head, summoning like thunder and lightning and tempests of rain and so forth. The hammer can shoot energy blasts. It can construct barriers, force fields, and he can spin at amazing speeds and fly with it. Although they've established Thor can fly without the hammer, but he uses it to kind of propel himself, essentially that unbreakable leather thong that he uses to spin around. He can pierce dimensional walls, create time vortexes, go back and forth in time using Mjolnir's power. This is the ultimate weapon.
Who needs a TARDIS?
In his possession. Any questions or comments on Mjolnir?
I think they do a good job in the movie of showing what Mjolnir does. As far as like the second Thor of the Dark World, when he's trying to throw it about and it's going off planet, coming back, like he just sticks his hand out and jumps and there it is to catch him, that kind of stuff. They do a pretty good job of making you aware of just how essential that is to him.
Absolutely, I agree.
Now, talking to the Whovians in the room here, talking of the hammer as a time travel device and who needs a TARDIS, apparently one writer, I want to say it was Roy Thomas, but I'm not 100% certain, saw the problems that Thor having the abilities to travel through time unchecked might cause. Thought it made him a little too powerful. They actually contrived a story involving Immortus and the Space Phantom, in which Thor voluntarily sacrificed the time travel capabilities of Mjolnir.
That's right. So well done.
He lost those powers after a little bit. But for a little while there, yep.
I thought you were going to go with they had a Doctor Who appearance and he zapped it with the sonic screwdriver to shut it off.
Nope, that would be cool, but
that's pretty good.
Not where I was going with that.
That he actually sacrificed. I don't know if I could do that.
Sherry, would you be so kind as to bring up the map of Asgard,
sure.
Please? If we're going to talk about Thor's powers and origin, we have to talk a little bit about Asgard itself. Now, Asgard, of course, has gone through various incarnations in the Marvel comic. For a period of time, it hovered above Oklahoma.
Yes.
For example.
Broxton.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we're talking about the Silver Age
version.
Had
a mailbox.
That's right. It did have a mailbox. Right now, we're talking about the Silver Age version of Asgard, the realm eternal. I love the Lee hyperbole in Thor. Now, Mer, do you pronounce it Aesir?
I put the accent on the first syllable. I think it's Aesir.
Okay, and that refers to the Asgardians, the people of Odin, essentially.
And there was also a second race of Asgardian gods called the Vanir.
That's correct.
Who were fairly prominent. They were like a race of fertility deities, I think. They're actually from the Old Norse myths, but they do eventually become semi-important in at least one story from the Silver Age, the Vanir do.
God, I'm glad Murd's here.
We'll get to it.
Now, so to talk a little bit about Asgard as it's interpreted in the Marvel Universe. So it's often known as the Nine Realms. So Asgard is one of the Nine Realms. Now, oftentimes you'll see it, and we'll put up some images in a moment, you'll see it portrayed as a huge sort of rock floating in space, essentially.
Was there a life tree also I'm thinking of? Is that something else?
Murd, go ahead.
The Yggdrasil, yes, the world ash. It's a gigantic ash tree. And it's kind of a like a cosmological metaphor for time and space. And
cosmological metaphor.
That's correct.
Exactly. Not a match, the board goes back.
I wish I understood that.
Password.
Okay. You need to watch more GSN, clearly.
Thank you.
But yeah, so each of the nine realms are thought to be like a different branch on this massive cosmic tree. And down at the base of it, there's this dragon named Nidhogg, and who guards this magic pool where prophecies can be
given. And that's all from Norse mythology.
Of course, yeah. And there's even a squirrel. There's like a that runs up and down this world ash, which actually appeared in the Unbeatable Squirrel Girl series recently. Ratatosk. Ratatosk the God Squirrel.
I don't know what to say. I don't know what to say after that.
Well, Pat, what I was going to say was think back to the first Thor film where he's having that intimate scene with Jane Foster on the rooftop, and he's sketching for her.
Yes.
He's explaining the world tree, essentially. Yeah. So they incorporate – thank you, Murd. They incorporate all of that into the comic, into the Marvel Universe. And the map Shane has up on the screen now, they show you the various realms. Now, some of these, of course, get a lot of play in the Marvel Universe. Some you don't hear much about. Others they mention all the time. Murd, did you want to comment on any of these particular realms?
Well, I can't see the map very well from where I'm at. Let's see. Muspelheim, Realm of the Fire Demons. Jotunheim, Realm of the Storm Giants. The movie conflates Niflheim and Jotunheim, because Niflheim is actually where the Frost Giants are from. Jotunheim, the Storm Giants, are a completely different race. Let's see. Nastrund, home of Fafnir, was a wizard who became a dragon through some misdeed of his own. Valhalla, of course, is it's like the Asgardian heaven, Realm of the Valiant Dead. And Hel, realm of the more shameful dead,
where the death goddess Hela resides.
Right, exactly.
Well, right.
The goddess herself in the Old Norse myths was called Hel. Also, she was like an eponym for her realm.
Right.
But so Marvel amended that to Hela, which I think is convenient. And Varenheim. I don't remember what's going on there. I don't see Svartalfheim on there, but it's.
No.
That's where the dark elves live. Scorn. I don't remember what Scornheim is either.
We should also mention.
Do you have an old map? Has it changed?
And also. I'm sorry, Mark. Go ahead.
Forest of the. Is that the. Yes, the Norn Forest, which is where Carnilla, the Asgardian sorceress.
Who's obsessed with Baldur.
Yes, so she's a fairly important character.
Yes,
so
she is.
She lives there.
And we should mention, of course, the Bifrost, which is also commonly known as the Rainbow Bridge. And. You'll notice in the map where they indicate Asgard. That's when they talk about Thor and the Asgardians. They're focusing on that part of the Nine Realms where Odin's people live, and of course they use the Bifrost to travel to Midgard, and I believe to other dimensions as well. There's other dimensions that are not shown on this map where they can also travel to. Essentially, Shane, would you call up the image, the Kirby image of Asgard, and the Rainbow Bridge, please? I think some of Kirby's most stunning art in the series, in the Silver Age, is his imagination, his imagining of Asgard, the realm eternal, and the Bifrost, or the Rainbow Bridge. And I think it's one of the most breathtaking images Kirby came up with throughout the Silver Age, essentially. Were you going to say something? I'm sorry.
Younger people watching at home, shout out if this image makes you think of Super Mario Kart. That's my generation.
Yeah. I'd go along with that, Murd.
Fantastic.
I hate that course.
The Asgard, again, we often see it portrayed in the comic, like on the image Shane has on the screen. It's based like a not a planetoid. It's like almost like a continent kind of floating in space, and it has its own atmosphere. In fact, there's one issue where Odin tells Thor, "There's a drought. Can you come home and create rain for us, please?" I thought the Asgardians have issues with their environment, I guess, but you know they have water. And you know it doesn't like nothing kind of like falls off the edges. Like, I guess they're their own kind of gravitational field, essentially. But it's some of Kirby's greatest imagery and just how he imagines Asgard. I remember when the Thor movie came out, and I saw it for the first time, and I was with Danielle and Bill, and they showed Asgard.
Yeah.
And I
went, did a great sweep across.
I turned to Danielle and I said, "Kirby." Yeah.
And set design in that movie was glorious.
Yeah. And I mean, there was some sort of funky Flash Gordon elements that kind of but you could definitely, like, I remember one point when they show this, they show like some sort of floating construct in the middle of space, like, oh, that's pure Kirby. So that was, and the huge statues towering over people, that was thrilling to see on the screen, essentially. But when you think, a phrase I think of when I think of Thor is glory and grandeur, and that's very much in Kirby's depiction of Asgard. Essentially. In fact, Shane, if you could go to the image of Odin, which is from Thor 143.
Oh, that same issue with the Enchantress and the Malt Shop.
He looks very dog-like to me in this picture.
But I have to read Thor's description of the All-Father. Because he's telling some kids about, because they want to know what life is like in Asgard. So he's recounting what it's like. And he says, "Yay! Beyond description, even as he who rules the fabled realm is beyond description, for he doth surpass all understanding. Let it suffice to know that he be Odin, the all-wise, the truly omnipotent. Odin, maker of the law, speaker of the word, keeper of the faith. Odin, the lasting power, the lightning wrath, the living judgment. Verily, he be Asgard incarnate, and to the god of thunder he be one thing more. He be flesh of my flesh, blood of my blood, for him do I call father." Excuse me. Now, I was almost overcome by the sheer drama of that, or melodrama, I should say.
I want to know why he drew Batman heads on his knuckles.
Wait, let me take a look at that. Look at that.
Right, he does look dog-like. I think it's that shadow on his nose.
It's the shadow on his nose, the way his hair and whiskers are with the eyes.
He just looks like a big pug.
Just does look a little bit odd.
But it's that just sheer cosmic grandeur that Kirby brought to this book that so thrilled me as I read these Silver Age issues, as I collected them as back issues or read reprints as I was growing up. So we can't understate the role of Asgard in these stories. And again, throughout the Silver Age, much of the tension is between Thor's duties to Asgard and his devotion to Midgard, which is Earth, and to the people of Earth. Any questions or comments about Asgard before we move on here?
Just that in my head I'm going, "Odin, he who was Disney's Shaggy Man."
Odin's will be a lot of fun to talk about. Now, and of course, as we mentioned, Asgard goes through its own incarnations throughout the history of the Marvel Universe. We mentioned it floats above Oklahoma at one point. It's destroyed at one point. Now I think it's called Asgardia, if I remember correctly.
You do.
Yeah.
Asgardia.
And is it floating up in space again? I think it is. It's definitely not above Oklahoma anymore.
It's not above Oklahoma.
Yeah. So maybe we'll get to that down the road.
Is it now Xanadu?
You know, I never saw that movie.
Oh, my God, it's fabulous.
Where nobody dared to go.
I can't tell you how many times I watched that on HBO as a kid.
I listen to that soundtrack all the time. I've seen the movie only once, but the soundtrack is 10 times better than the movies.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I got to put that on my list, Shane.
Xanadu.
That and that horrible sci-fi film where Sean Connery is running around in like a leotard.
Oh,
or
like Zartox.
Zartox, yeah.
Or Zardoz.
I'm sure I've seen that.
There we go. Yeah, the DC character Vartox is actually based on him in that movie.
All right, let's plunge into the checklist. And let's talk about just some of Thor's key moments, appearances, classic plot lines from the Silver Age. And as we go through, you're going to notice that they kind of start off Thor the way they start off a lot of the Marvel heroes, in that he ends up inevitably fighting communists, which was a favorite plot device of Stan Lee in the early Silver Age.
And of his brother, too. Larry was big into writing Red Scare type
plots. The commies! All right? So, and there's one Thor story just entitled Prisoner of the Reds. So, I love that early Cold War paranoia of the 60s.
Yeah, all-powerful Thor captured by the Russians.
Actually, I think it was the Chinese in the Chinese story. Okay. So it kind of starts with that type of story. And then as the series progresses, and a lot of this I'm sure is Kirby's input, it just starts to blow up with this incredible sense of operatic, you know, Wagnerian grandeur. And Lee starts to include the Elizabethan dialogue with the characters. And I can't overstate enough the importance of the Tales of Asgard, which was backup stories in Journey into Mystery 97 to 125, then in the Mighty Thor issue series 126 to 145. Now, those stories heavily incorporate Norse mythology, but then they adapt it to the Marvel Universe, essentially. And some of the stories are about basically the genesis of the Asgardians. Others are about stories about Thor in his youth. There's a classic story, which is the origin of Loki, and, you know, the frost giants and all of that. And there's a longer epic in Tales of Asgard, which introduces the Warriors 3, which we'll get to, which takes place in sort of the current continuity of that time, where Thor is sent on a quest on this magnificent, like, Viking longship that floats through space, because they're concerned that an artifact known as the Oversword, if it's pulled from its sheath, is like the beginning of Ragnarok.
Oh, yes.
Has been rattled or is in danger of some kind, and Thor is sent on a quest by Odin to prevent all this from happening. Now, I have to make a very important point here. Not because this is another recurring theme in the Silver Age. Not only is Odin often a dick, when it comes to Loki, Odin is often also very dim. You're going to find over and over again, Odin will give Loki multiple chances. At one point, he'll even give Loki some of his power and leave him in charge of Asgard. And then inevitably, of course, Loki gets up to mischief because he's the trickster god. And all kinds of mayhem ensues. Odin comes back. He punishes Loki. Then he gives him more power down the road again, or he trusts him. Like, when they go on this quest in the longship, Odin insists that Thor and Loki are the co-commanders of the quest. You can imagine how that works out.
This shall end well.
Yes.
Both of you lead.
But it's hilarious. And I'll get to one particular plot I thought was especially, you know, a scream. How Odin will be duped by Loki over and over again. Granted, he is the god of tricks, but throughout these stories, it's exasperatingly funny as we go through these. So we'll touch upon some of those as well as we move through the checklist. Now, as Murd mentioned, Journey to Mystery 83, the Stone Men from Saturn. Now, think back to Thor the Dark World. When he's in that melee in the beginning, remember he comes from the sky and, like, smashes right through that stone beam. Yeah. That's a stone man from Saturn. That's clearly what that was inspired by. Now, Murr, don't they have another name?
Yes. They're okay. Not really from Saturn at all, of course. They're from a planet called Krona, so they're called Kronans. But that's
retro-continuity, right?
Oh, yes, of course. Yeah.
So,
yeah, during the whole Hulk, the Planet Hulk story, when Hulk was...
of them is in the Gladiator Pit, isn't it?
Exactly.
Isn't it? Yeah, that's right.
He's a Borg, I think, or something. Korg. Yeah.
So in this early story, you know, alien menace from outer space. It's a classic plot device of, you know, the early Silver Age. We were introduced to Donald Blake, who is a renowned doctor and surgeon on vacation in Norway. you know, he's limp. He has a limp. He's lame. He has his walking cane, and the stone men from Saturn arrive in a scout craft, and Blake sees them. They chase him. And he's drawn to this cave, this ancient cave, and he gets trapped in. This is his old gnarled walking stick. And Shane, could go back to the origin page, please.
Yippers.
Thank you. And he tries to use the cane as like a lever to open the entrance to the cave because he's blocked and he can't. His frustration, he strikes it, and then he's transformed. And Blake realizes that he now has the power of the ancient Norse god Thor. Essentially. Now, if you look at the imagery, the costume of Thor hasn't changed that much.
No.
Well, I mean, it's since changed from the Straczynski era forward, but from the Silver Age well into the Simonson era, that's basically Thor's costume. It's been tweaked a little bit, maybe the boots a little bit, the way they're portrayed, but that's basically the costume that Kirby initially designed. Now, you'll notice these early stories, Thor is not speaking in Lee's pseudo-Elizabethan dialogue.
Yeah, because Thor really isn't Thor. It's Dr. Donald Blake.
Yes.
He's still believing that he is a human being
exactly.
at this point. And he's just, there's one scene in this issue where he's trying to remember, what do I remember of Thor from my school days?
Exactly, exactly.
So it's not so much that he is Thor, it's that he's still Donald Blake just wearing Thor's body.
Exactly. So he has manifested Thor's powers, but as you read the story, as Murder's right on the money, it's Blake reveling in this power, and you're right, trying to remember, well, what I learned about Thor when I was a kid, and, you know, well, Thursday's named after him, he says that, for example. And in the initial stories, that's the way they kind of portray Thor. Like, it's like, all right, it's another Marvel superhero. It's a guy who has these powers. But as the series progresses, they sort of twist that and put that on its head, and you start to realize this isn't a human being with the powers of Thor. This is Thor, essentially. And eventually they're going to explain, well, who the heck is Donald Blake then? And they're going to get into that over time. Now, issue 84.
Oh, just a please. The last panel of 83 of his story 83 knocks me out. It's an editor's note. He goes, Thor, the mighty, the greatest new superhero of all time, will appear regularly in Journey to Mystery. Reserve next month's issue at your news dealer now. It's sure to be a sellout. I never thought to reserve at my news dealer when I was in the 70s. So many issues I would have missed. Could you have done that back in the 60s? Reserve at your news dealer?
I guess if you had a good relationship with the local.
Yeah, wow. I think if you went to the same one and
oh,
you were...
I guess because I... Anyway, just, I was always bummy trying to get issues in the 70s. I would miss two issues here and there.
Pants, I was in the same boat because, you know, I didn't discover a local comic shop till the 80s. So when I was getting comics in the late 70s and early 80s, I was captive to the convenience store
right.
or a flea market. Mm-hmm. So you got whatever was there, and that was it. So it's
anyway,
true.
Yes.
Well, now, didn't they inexplicably spell Thor with two R's in that last panel?
Not in this
Okay, I want to say in the original they did. Someone can correct me on that, on the forums if I'm wrong there. Now, issue 84 is by Lieber, Kirby, and the great inker Dick Ayers, who often inked Kirby in the early Silver Age. First appearance of Jane Foster. Now, Jane Foster first appears as a nurse who works for Donald Blake. Ah, the days when your doctor had a local office. You didn't have to, you know, worry about going broke and losing your home if you had some kind of, you know, severe medical emergency. There wasn't even medical insurance back then because you could actually afford to pay the doctor.
That's right.
Don't get me started on that tangent. So, now when Jane is first rendered and realizes the character of the Silver Age, I think it's fair to say she's the typical Stan Lee female supporting character. Murray, you're rolling your eyes. What do you think I mean by that?
I think you mean that she's kind of simpering and weak, and for her main personality trait is making goo-goo eyes at the hero.
Pretty much. And being the damsel in distress.
Oh, yes.
That. Or a source of jealousy, things of that nature. Now, as we all know, of course, the Jane Foster that we see in comics today is a dramatically different, although it's still the same character. The history is all there, but it's a dramatically different character, because we all know who she is. So I can say that, right? Because she's Thor now. So, and that's we'll talk about that. I'm sure hopefully down the road. But this Jane Foster in the early Silver Age, and Murder's right on the money here. It's classic. It's like way Karen Page was portrayed, the way Sue Storm was portrayed, the Invisible. Then she was known as the Invisible Girl. Many of these female characters, very very physically beautiful. Intelligent, but very much there to either moon over the hero or to be a distraction for the hero or to be a source of jealousy or things of that nature.
An objective for the hero.
Yeah. So Jane is Donald Blake's nurse, and one of the plot devices in this era is she definitely has feelings for Donald Blake, but she's very much more drawn to Thor. And, of course, one of the agonies is that Blake is like, I want to tell her I'm actually Thor. And, of course, we learn dear old dad, Odin, constantly forbids Thor from revealing his identity to Jane, which is a source of tension and frustration between Thor and his father, the All-Father, Odin, who is the Word and the Way. Now, this story also introduces the Executioner. Want to hold forth on him for a moment?
Okay, well, this is not the more famous of the executioner characters that Thor has faced over the years. This is, it's not Scourge.
Oh, it's not the Norse executioner. I'm
nope,
sorry.
This is a different guy. That's He's right. just a petty dictator of the South American country of San Diablo.
And Pants? He's a commie!
No!
A dirty, dirty red!
He's a pico!
So yeah, he rules this South American country, San Diego, which the name translates to Saint Devil. So that all kinds of sense there. And yeah, so Thor beats him up and all of his hombres, and I guess liberates the country.
Yep. So for the power of democracy, forces of freedom. We have to remember when these stories are being written. I mean, think about Fantastic Four 1. We're not going to let the commies beat us into space, right? That Lee's tapping into the sort of the cultural zeitgeist of that time, which was, remember, this is the early 60s, the Cuban Missile Crisis was unfolding, the space race, so that was very much on people's minds. And Iron Man, my God, is all about those early stories. The Red Menace, right?
Oh, yeah, international arms race.
Yeah, so that seeps into a lot of the early Marvel stories. Now, I think about the first appearance, the Hulk. Was it the Gremlin? The communist Asian he faces in that?
I can never remember if it's the Gremlin or the Gargoyle.
I think it's the Gargoyle. It's the Gargoyle, yeah. So,
yeah, and there was a spy named Igor Drenkov who was present. I think he's the one who actually fouled up the detonation.
That's right. So, and then, of course, you know, these are all classic Cold War motifs that Lee was working in here and Lieber working in here. Now, issue 85 is a very important issue in the early history of the Mighty Thor. Look at the laundry list of first appearances here. So we've got Baldur the Brave, Odin, Heimdall, Loki, and Tyr. Now, we all know who Odin is. Now, Heimdall, of course, is the guardian of the Bifrost, the Rainbow Bridge. He is like the sentinel, you know, who guards the gateway between Asgard and other dimensions. Merge, you want to say something? I'm sorry.
Nope.
Go ahead.
Well, okay, I'll throw in. I think he's the one who was responsible for Loki getting set free, if I'm remembering that part of the story correctly.
Yes.
Is it him or Baldur? I forget.
No, it's right here.
Okay. We'll get to that in a second. Okay. Now, Tyr is god of the lightning?
I believe he's a war god.
War god.
I think
okay.
of him as the like the equivalent of Ares, approximately. Okay. And he's one-handed. That's his
right.
major physical trait. One of his hands was chopped off some time ago.
And, of course, Baldur the Brave, who I'm sorry to say has not been put in the movies. Maybe they felt they just had enough Asgardians there. I don't know. But he's one of Thor's closest friends. And I think in modern continuity they've established that it's actually Thor's half-brother, if I remember correctly. And he's one of the most powerful of all the Asgardians. He's completely loyal to Thor. He's fought by his side innumerable times. He actually had his own miniseries. Simonson did a lot with Baldur when he was helming the characters in the 1980s. And he plays a key role throughout the Silver Age as well. And, of course, this is the first appearance of the Marvel version of Loki, God of Mischief. Or sometimes they call him the God of Evil as well, the Trickster God. And, of course, he is Odin's sort of stepson. When Odin had smited his Loki's father, Laufey, and they show you that version of that in the film, he takes pity and adopts Loki as his own. Big mistake. And Loki, of course, grows up alongside Thor as brothers. But, of course, we all know Loki, this jealousy burns in Loki's bosom. Because he feels he's better than Thor, superior to Thor, that Thor has all the glory, Thor is heir to the throne, and Loki just can't abide the fact that his, as he often says, my doltish half-brother stepbrother is, you know, above me, essentially. Now, as Pants mentioned, so Odin periodically will banish Loki or imprison him for his misdeeds, so he's encased Loki in a tree, and according to the spell, if someone sheds a tear over Loki, he'll be freed. And I think Loki gains control of a leaf, and he makes it fall
yep.
from the tree. And is it Tyr then sheds a tear over the leaf, and then Loki is broken free from his imprisonment?
Yeah,
yep.
Leaf goes straight into Heimdall's eye and causes him
Heimdall's eye. Excuse me, not
to tear up.
And then Loki's free.
It's
this kind of thing will happen in various forms over and over and over. If Brian Deemer here would be shouting right now, just kill him! I mean,
he would too.
I mean, later on they reveal that Odin will have this somber moment where he tells the Asgardians, when Ragnarok occurs, Loki will be the cause of it. I can hear. I heard Brian Deemer shouting from the hilltops. Then you kill him, obviously.
Just like Joker.
Yeah. Or Bullseye, right? You kill him anyway. Murd, issue 86. I couldn't wait till you talk about Zarko.
Yes. Artur Zarko, the Tomorrow Man from the 27th century, the year 2662 AD, to be precise. Yeah, his origin runs somewhat similar to Kang's, actually. And they were
the Conqueror.
Yes, exactly. He comes from a future time that's a little too peaceful for his taste, so he jury-rigs some time travel technology and travels to the past to cause mischief. Comes back to get his hands on a weapon, I believe. And Thor thwarts him.
And we should mention, again, that Cold War aspect in this story. Thor decides to help the U.S. military test missiles and their new weapon, the Cobalt Bomb, and he allows the bomb to be detonated near him so the military can study its effects, essentially. So it's fun, from a 21st century perspective, watching a superhero allow the military to use him as a guinea pig to test, you know, weapons that potentially threaten all of the human race.
Sure. I have nothing to fear. Blast away.
Fantastic. And this is the first issue where Mjolnir demonstrates time travel capabilities. Right. And Murd mentioned eventually those will be stripped from the Oru hammer. 87, all I have to shout is, Prisoner of the Reds! So Thor ends up in communist China. Again, like the communist bugaboo is being tapped here for all it's worth, essentially, as a plot device. Shan, I thought of you as I was reading about issue 88.
Oh, yeah?
Because it just reminded me of your sense of humor, because I know you'll find this funny. So, Loki's up to one of his innumerable schemes. And at the climax of the story, he disguises himself as a pigeon among a flock of pigeons.
Sure.
And so the idea is Thor can't tell which pigeon is false, so he takes a bag of peanuts. I love early Marvel Silver Age.
This is an old gag. Odysseus actually used a ruse like this to find the disguised Achilles in one part of the Trojan War. He was disguised as a woman.
From the Iliad.
So exactly. And so Odysseus showed up with disguised as a peddler and displayed a bunch of
pretty
baubles.
That's right, I remember that. Well done,
Murd. To attract the women, and then also displayed some daggers and weapons. And the one of the women at this place that fingered the weapons, Odysseus discerned was Achilles.
Can I give Lee more credit that he was tapping into some Homer there, mm-hmm. apparently.
Mm-hmm.
So
pigeons are funnier, though.
Yes, well, especially because just as we see here, so Loki's not drawn to the peanuts, so obviously Thor figures out which pigeon is false, and then he happens to then ensnare the false pigeon in a tennis net, thereby capturing Loki yet again.
I've done that with things flying in my house over time.
Fantastic.
Or I thought of also when he said a flock of pigeons of doing the pigeon. Doing the pigeon.
I have that on 33.
I have it on a, what's the bigger one? 45?
33.
30, is that 33?
33 and a third. Birch Greatest that. Hits.
Yep. I have a whole Sesame Street album.
Oh,
yet.
My God. We digress. I'm sorry.
I love your digressions. Never doing never fear. Shane, would you go to the
Dancing
Journey of Mystery 89 cover, please?
Every day.
The kind of ballet sweeps me away.
Pants acting as minstrel. Fantastic.
Oh my God. Hey, you can't go wrong
you
with
can't
Sesame
go wrong
Street.
With Bert singing his greatest
yeah.
hits.
That's true. Now, this is, I think... this
that was poor Ernie. That was more Muttley than Ernie.
This is one of, I think, one of the great Silver Age images of Thor. Yeah. We've probably all seen this in various media because it's Kirby. And I think the first Thor t-shirt they did in the 60s was this image. This is a very famous image of Thor, him preparing to go into flight or to battle, whirling the hammer around by the leather thong, his other arm outstretched. Classic Thor pose, vintage Kirby. You see it used over and over again.
And what looks like tiger boots the way they're drawn.
Ah. Good old Shaney Poo. Now, I should mention in these early issues, Kirby doesn't pencil every issue of Journey into Mystery. He and Lee don't start their uninterrupted partnership a little bit later on in the book, so other people are writing at different times, usually from plots Lee has conceived. And Kirby pencils some, but like, for example, Al Hartley pencils this issue. Joe Sinnott pencils some issues. And Kirby will pop in and out as well. Now, issue 90, This begins the great frustration, both spiritual and sexual, for Thor, as he petitions his father for his permission to reveal his identity to Jane to win her love. Because Jane always pines about how great Thor is in the presence of Donald Blake. And Odin just outright refuses. And this is the key tension between father and son throughout much of the Silver Age. It leads to some great drama and, frankly, some really ridiculous situations where Odin makes decisions that are, because he's so angry about Thor having the hots for a mortal, he leads to some very ill-conceived command decisions on his part, as we're going to see. But that all kind of starts here. Now, issue 91, Joe Sinnott pencils. Remember, Sinnott is a penciler in his own right, as well as a legendary inker. Murray, do you remember who Sandu was?
Vaguely. Sandu the Mystic.
Yes.
And he's just a human being who was used as a cat's paw by Loki. Because, you know, in one of the many reversals of his relationship with Odin, as you pointed out, Chris, he was kind of on the downs with Odin at this point, and he had been forced to swear that he wouldn't strike against Thor on Earth, so he found this Sandu guy and imbued him with a bunch of his Loki's own mystical power and sent him against Thor.
That's not the first time Loki will use other agents as proxies to strike out against Thor. We'll see that as we go through the checklist.
Master manipulator, that one.
Indeed. Now, issue 91 also introduced another element of Norse mythology, which is the Valkyries. And in this story, apparently, Odin wants to provide Thor with a strength-enhancing belt. I love how this is classic early Silver Age, where those kind of come up with powers off the cuff to kind of help propel a certain plot along. And the Valkyries are sent to Midgard, which is what the Asgardians refer to Earth as, to provide Thor with this belt. So you'll see at various times, Lieber will snatch different elements of Norse mythology and incorporate them into this their own version of this character that they're creating here in his world. Now, Loki pops again in issue 90. Loki appears constantly throughout the Marvel Silver Age. We're not going to go into every single one of his appearances in detail.
92 is also significant because it's the first appearance of Frigga.
Explain, please, sir, the significance of Frigga.
Well, she's Odin's wife. She's the matriarch of Asgard. She's actually also the All-Mother in the current...
But not Thor's, as you said, natural mother.
Right.
But she raised him,
as if he were her own.
Yeah.
Yes, and she's always been... She's been a constant and stabilizing presence in the halls of Asgard.
And I'm wondering, because, you know, that they... Of course, she dies in Thor the Dark World. I'm wondering if they're ever going to explore in the movies. Maybe they just don't have the time. As we know, Thor's ties to Earth in terms of his birth. I don't know if they're going to ever go into that. It'd be interesting if they did. But
I'm just glad that Frigga in that movie got to have a warrior's death.
She did.
I would say, because Disney owns Marvel, probably not.
That's it.
I think they will keep it more wholesome, for lack of a better way to explain it. It'll be, that's his mom and that's it. Versus...
Yeah, kind of like Disney's Hercules.
Yeah.
A fair observation.
Where Hera is definitely Hercules' mother, which is absolutely not true in the Greco-Roman myths.
Now, they may
not have any input. I mean, it is Marvel Studios, but it's my guess is they won't go down that road.
Yeah, I think it's a valid observation, my friend. Now, issue 93, we have Kirby penciling. First appearance of the Radioactive Man. Of course, commies again, communist China. Murray, what's the basic... what's the base of the Radioactive Man?
Okay, he is a red Chinaman. Actually, he's a green Chinaman, because Dr. Chen Liu, who is a power-hungry Chinese scientist, who steps forward and volunteers to use his research into radioactivity to mutate himself into a powerhouse to challenge Thor, because apparently some high-ranking Chinese communist official has taken it into his head that Thor is the ultimate symbol of the decadent West. And he is the one superhero among dozens popping up in the United States that China needs to be concerned about. And so Chen Liu uses radiation, certain wavelengths he's discovered, to bombard himself and turn into this hulking green... Hulk is kind of a loaded word, but this powerful green human reactor who can produce just many, many, many megarads of destructive radiation and fire it as blasts.
And he's been used quite a bit since then.
Oh, yes.
You remember the Thunderbolts.
He was, during the second volume, was written by Fabian Nicieza.
Yeah.
Tom Grummett penciling.
He's been around quite a. He's been used quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's probably some of the best characterization he's ever gotten. Probably the
only real characterization he's ever received in terms of depth.
Otherwise, he's just kind of a, you know, just a generic commie caricature.
Exactly, but again, because of the complexity of the Thunderbolts, and yes, ladies and gentlemen, I know I talked a while back about a Thunderbolt spotlight. It is in the queue.
you have to have Thor before you can have Thunderbolts.
Exactly. Thank you for that save there, Murd.
Justice like lightning.
Outstanding. But because the Thunderbolts were all about the sort of shades of gray, and the Reactive Man characters, I think, benefited from that approach, essentially. We'll get to the Thunderbolts eventually. Now, issue 94, Loki pops up yet again. He temporarily gains control of Thor mentally for a brief period of time and makes mischief. Again, we have to emphasize just what drives Loki is that sense of being hard done by, that I'm should be the rightful ruler of Asgard. I'm the one who should claim the throne. You know, Thor is not the true heir. I am. I have the intellect and the power and so forth and so on. We should also mention, though, that, and they show this very well in the movies, that even though Loki makes so much trouble for Thor, Thor cannot totally disassociate himself from the fact that he still sees Loki as his brother. And there's still a feeling of, I don't know if love's the right word, maybe compassion or sense of mercy to some degree. So it's just something, and again, all credit to Tom Hiddleston for just, I think, rendering Loki so masterfully on the screen.
They do a great job of throwing in that little tiny scene of them as kids while Odin's telling them stories, too.
That's an excellent
scene.
That
really shows how close they were at one point.
And the competition.
Yeah. Yeah, because
they raced down the hallway.
Thor's like, yeah, I did this. Oh, well, I won two, too. Yeah.
Yep. Indeed. Now, issue 95, as I mentioned, this is Lee plotting, and a writer. I'm not familiar with him. Robert Bernstein did the scripting here. Anybody know anything about him?
It's the first time I've heard of him, too.
Mr. Wethington. Now, I mentioned this issue because I just thought it was funny that there's a drought in Asgard, so Odin asks Thor to return so he can conjure up rain so there's no more drought. So I guess Odin doesn't have full power over the environment in Asgard. Go ahead, please.
All right. According to Comic Book DB, Robert Bernstein, co-creator of DC's Kong Gorilla, Aqualad, Aqua Girl, and Archie Comics, The Jaguar.
Ooh. Oh, wow.
Wow. It's a pretty good pedigree.
Yeah, he's got a pretty good bibliography here.
So it's not like he did most of his work with DC then, rather than
There's some Marvel stuff here. There's the Human Torch I see here. A couple other things. Of course, Thor, Tales to Astonish, Tales of Suspense.
So he was very much present in the early Silver Age then, it sounds like.
Yeah, he was born in 1919, passed in 1988, so we have to sort of write in.
All right. Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm. Now, issue 96, again, I just thought this was fun. The Thor battle Merlin. So
not the Merlin.
I knew you were going to. Please, I had a feeling it wasn't the real Merlin. Go ahead, Merlin.
This is.
I knew it.
This is. Well, it's a character who's gone by several names over the years, but he's been called Merlin the Mad. Mm. He's been called Merlin Demon Spawn. He called himself the Warlock for a little while. Most recently, he's been called Mahayogi. And he's not really Merlin at all. He's a character who has kind of a similar origin, a shared origin, really, with Ulysses Bloodstone, the famous, well, not so famous, maybe, but 1970s Marvel Monster Hunter character, who's kind of like Vandal Savage in that he was like a caveman, a Neanderthal, who encountered a mystic relic called the Blood Gem, which got embedded in his chest and gave him immortality and similar powers. So this person who became Merlin got a fragment of this blood gem in himself, which gave him extreme longevity, and eventually he acquired various mystical and quasi-mystical powers. He impersonated Merlin for a time in the days of Camelot, and then he was sealed away in a casket, and Thor was the one who got to release him upon the modern-day Marvel Universe.
See, ladies and gentlemen, what I want you to understand here is, as I was preparing the spotlight, I thought, okay, you know, time is always limited. I thought to myself, I doubt that's the Arthurian Merlin, but I know. I didn't have to check. I said, I just know that Murd will be able to handle that. And I've said it before. If I'm in battle and I'm in that foxhole, I'm about to be overrun by the commies. And
I'll throw myself on that grenade for you.
Not even that, Murd. You run up with those tins full of machine gun ammunition that'll save us the last minute. You want to go into battle, ladies and gentlemen? That's the man you want by your side right there. Now,
but you're our top kick, Chris.
Honored, sir. All right, issue 97, very important. Tales of Asgard begins. Now, again, these are backup stories, all Lee and Kirby, that run, again, from issue 97 through the end of Journey to Mystery, which is through issue 125. And then it continues in Thor from issue 126, I want to say, through 143.
Yeah, I'm looking through.
I lost track of my notes here for a minute. Forgive me.
Yeah, the last, I think it's number 145. I don't think it's officially
called. You're correct, Bird. 145. That's correct. Yep.
It's basically the Warriors 3 show by then.
Yes.
But yeah, that's the last one.
As I said, Tales of Asgard. And Shane, could you go to the Tales of Asgard cover for me, please? Hopefully I labeled that one correctly.
I shall search.
Basically, yeah, it's called Tales of Asgard. Marvel collected these a couple times. In the late 60s, they did a thick, glue-bound comic, which reprinted some of those stories. The image Shane's going to bring up the screen is the Kirby cover to that original reprint comic. You find them, Shane?
No, I got all the Journeys to Mysteries. Let's flick some other buttons.
It's entitled Tales of Asgard. As you'll find it. I'll just talk about it. So they've used the image several times.
Button 10.
And Marvel did, not too long ago, they did a hardcover, a beautiful hardcover. They recolored it, and they collected the entire Tales of Asgard series in one bound edition. It came out in, let's see here, 2010. I'm not sure if it's still in print. I hope it is. But if you're a fan of the Mighty Thor, did you find the image?
Yep.
Thank you. If you're a fan of the Mighty Thor, you got to read these stories. Because not only is it Lee and Kirby, my gut feeling is a lot of this is really Kirby. Not only incorporating a lot of the Asgardian legends and myths into the origins of sort of the Marvel Universe version of Asgard, they also delve deeper into the characters that they're elaborating upon. Like they have, you know, the first appearance of Lady Sif in Tales of Asgard. They have, they talk about Thor and Loki in their youths. They give the origin of Loki as he's found by Odin. And the centerpiece is this magnificent epic, where, as I mentioned, in sort of the current continuity of the Silver Age, Odin sends Thor, Loki, and the Warriors 3 on a quest to prevent the coming of Ragnarok and to save, you know, prevent the removal of the Oversword, essentially.
And how many issues does that quest go on?
I'd have to look that up. I don't know off the top of my head. It's several, though. And it's breathtaking Kirby art. The Viking longship that floats through space, it's magnificent. Bald of the Brave is also in those stories. Those stories alone are worth getting the Tales of Asgard collection.
Thank you for that, because I was looking through. I have my Masterworks edition of Thor, and they're not in there.
Oh, they're not, because they start with 97, right?
I'm at 97, and I only have the first volume with me.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's only the Thor story. So it's like, that's what why I love having issues, because there's other story besides the Thor in Journey to the Mystery.
There are.
Behind this rain here, I mean, sometimes three other stories,
mm-hmm.
even with some like Dicko artwork of other things, and, you know, hell, if I'm ever going to see those in my lifetime without getting a copy of the
issue. And I'm glad you brought that up, Pants, because we have to remember that Journey to Mystery, like Tales of Suspense, like Tales to Astonish, like Strange Tales of the Marvel House books, that's what they would have before they got in the superheroes. That's what they had a lot of the monster stories mm-hmm. that Kirby would do, the sort of the creepy...
like a Twilight Zone style,
that Ditko would do, right?
Moralistic science fiction
exactly.
tales.
The Atlas era stuff,
sure,
essentially. And those, you're right, those continued into the Marvel Silver Age as backup stories. Mm-hmm. Such. Remember, going back to the history, when Martin Goodman lost his distributor, he had to go, this must have been humiliating, he had to go hat in hand to DC to ask if DC's in-house distribution arm, Independent News, would distribute his comics. And DC said, sure, we'll do it for you, but you can only print 8 titles a month.
Yeah.
So that's one of the reasons why these books are so important, is that's how they were able to introduce a lot of these characters. They could put two heroes or multiple heroes into one issue, essentially. That's why events like Tales to Astonish would be the Hulk and Ant-Man or Hulk and Submariner. Tales of Suspense, Captain America, Iron Man. Journey to Mystery, Thor. Strange Tales, Doctor Strange and Nick Fury. So,
and this appeared to be a monthly book at the time, Journey to Mystery.
Oh, yeah, it was.
Some were not of that era.
Those titles, Strange Tales, Tales of Suspense, Journey to Mystery, Tales to Astonish, those were four of Marvel's foundational books, basically, going into the 1960s. And a lot of it's because of that distribution issue that I just described. Mm-hmm. I should mention, if people are interested, when we did a couple years ago with Jamie D, our two-part History of the Fantastic Four and the Silver Age, we talk about the history of Marvel in much greater details. Mm-hmm. If you're interested in that, definitely check that out. That was a labor of love, that one. Now, in issue 97, besides Tales of Asgard, we also have Odin once again telling Thor you cannot get together with Jane Foster. Jane is so upset because she's frustrated by Donald Blake, doesn't seem interested enough in her, yet she's also pining for Thor, that she quits Blake's doctor's office, at least temporarily. It's also the first appearance of the Lava Man. Murder, any information on him?
Well, he was a man made out of lava.
There you go! Hell, I could have done that!
Yeah, he was probably hot.
Much later on, we learn that he's a distant relative of the Moloids. Like, there's a whole race of lava men who can like combine and turn into a giant lava. Yeah, but at first
become
he was
a lava mountain.
It's a guy made out of lava. That's all you need.
It's a pretty one-dimensional villain in his first appearance.
He and Thor actually part on friendly terms at the end of that story, though. So
that's right. I forgot. About
me no burn Thor.
So when the lava men show up in the Avengers a little later on, that one lava man is there to put in a good word for Thor with his fellow lava men.
Yeah, by the way, I'm sorry. Just want to throw in there if you haven't. We've actually come to the point now where the Avengers has come out. Issue 1 came out the same month, according to Comic Book DB, as Journey Mystery number 96. So now we're seeing Thor in two books.
And the Avengers will start to appear in some of these issues, as well. Well done, sir.
I'm reading a screen. That's not that well done.
It's the clutch moment.
It's instinctive. You knew which screen to read. You knew the computer in front of you is the one you have to read.
And Shane's here.
Just now, like me, I get to push the buttons. Boom! Boom!
Okay, now we're getting calls from the area kettles. We've got to knock it off.
Don't get drunk with power there, buddy.
Boom, 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 boom!
I gave everyone a
headache.
Stave off the laughing fit that's going to emerge. All right, now, that issue of Tales of Asgard also produces, again, other characters from Norse mythology that are important. Is it Bori or Buri?
Bori,
who was the grandfather of Odin. So Thor's great-grandfather. Bor, who was actually shown in the Dark World fighting the Dark Elves. Remember when Odin recounts that history?
That was actually cool. That was really cool.
And then
cool
Jane
spot.
Foster says, well, what happened? He just says, well, he killed them.
Yeah.
I loved Hopkins' delivery there. Ymir, is he a frost giant?
Yes, he is. Okay.
And a very important opponent of the Asgardians, Surtur, the fire demon.
Mm-hmm.
Who appears a lot in the Thor comics. Simonson does a lot with Surtur as well.
Oh, yes, a whole lot.
And, of course, Jotunheim and Muspelheim?
Either way.
Yeah, is also introduced.
Yeah, that is the realm of the fire demons where Surtur holds sway.
And Jotunheim is storm giants?
Storm giants, right.
But Niflheim. in the movie they make it the frost giants.
Yeah, getting their realms mixed up.
And Yggdrasil, the world tree, is also introduced in that issue of Tales, that first issue of Tales of Asgard. So they start with like an origin story of that whole of the nine realms, essentially, and based on Norse mythology. So I can't emphasize enough how fun the Tales of Asgard stories are. It's all Kirby art, first of all. And it's just a great melding of sort of Norse mythology with the Marvel universe, essentially, as it moves forward. Now, issue 98, a Pence I always like to mention because he's often overlooked, yet he's also one of the architects of the Marvel Universe, which is Don Heck. Mm-hmm. We have to remember that Don Heck drew many of the early issues of the Avengers, of Iron Man, and he pencils this issue of Journey into Mystery. I think Don Heck was
the Thor story.
Yes. Thank you, sir. I think Don Heck was a wonderful penciler. He especially drew beautiful women, and he often gets overlooked in the shadow of Ditko and Kirby, but he's one of the early foundational Marvel artists as well, and he should be acknowledged for that. In fact, Tomorrow has recently did a wonderful retrospective of Don Heck's career.
I think it's on our bookshelf over there.
Yes, and I have a copy at home as well. Yep. Wonderful. Great artist. Now, in issue 98, Donald Blake is so crestfallen over not being able to be with Jane, and when you don't get the girl, where do you go? Well, you go to India. So Blake goes to India to try to forget Jane, and there he meets the Cobra. Klaus Voorhees, Murd, fire away.
Okay, well, he's a Dutchman, and he was a...
Hate the Dutch.
Yeah, I was thinking that, too.
Yes.
The Dutch.
Gold member, right. So he was a criminal, a convict, and he was in a prison work release where he was working under the renowned herpetologist, Professor Ezekiel Schechter.
Gotta be kidding me! You're making all this shit up,
he
aren't you?
Right off the top of my head.
Herpetologist?
The man's a mutant!
Snake scientist,
okay?
And he was jealous of Dr. Schechter's discoveries, so he decides he's going to kill him and steal all of his discoveries. So he used irradiated cobra venom to try and off the guy and to allay suspicion. He used a little on himself, too, not knowing that it would interact with his body chemistry and give him snake-like powers. So he had enhanced like strength and speed and superhuman flexibility and agility, making him quite possibly the world's greatest contortionist. And naturally, devised some snake-based gimmicks and a special costume for himself and turned to crime, as so many people do in these situations. In the
I shall defeat you by contorting myself.
And in fact, one of the most beloved Amazing Spider-Man issues from the classic Roger Stern era.
Right. Knight of the Cobra, I think.
Yeah.
Why are you even here?
I want to say it's issue 232. Can you check that for me, Pants?
Sure.
All right.
I got a little but going on.
It's my first God, that was bleak. Come on. It's his first introduction, my first introduction to Cobra. Remember in that story, he infiltrates the police property lockup through the sewer system to steal jewels, then goes back into the sewer system as only he can shimmy, basically.
Mm-hmm. His entire skeleton is so flexible.
Yeah. And it was... I was just really all my. I always loved the costume. I was always.
You say hide in plain sight? Is that what you said?
Yeah, I think so.
232.
Well done, sir.
Or
might
thanks.
Have been, or even 231. What's the title? 231.
Caught in the act.
All right. It's one.
Jeez, it's the cops.
It's one of those two. Now. So the Cobra is I mentioned a murder before this episode. What I was counting on from him was that a lot of classic Marvel villains are introduced in early Thor Silver Age adventures. We're just starting to get into that right now. We already mentioned the Radioactive Man. We've mentioned the Asgard Executioner is going to show up.
The Tomorrow Man.
Tomorrow Man. And the next issue, issue 99, also by Lee and Heck, Mr. Hyde.
Mm-hmm.
Murd, well, go ahead. Calvin Zabo.
Yep, right. Calvin Zabo, he was a corrupt medical researcher. He had this personal obsession with the story of the strange case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde by Robert Louis Stevenson, was convinced that there was a basis in biochemical fact for Stevenson's story that the correct chemical mixture could bring out the evil side of a person's nature and thereby empower that person. And so he'd been embezzling subtly from a variety of different doctors and hospitals and facilities he'd been working for in order to fund this little pet project of his to isolate this chemical compound. He applied for work with Dr. Donald Blake, but by this time Zabo had acquired kind of an unsavory reputation. Nothing had ever been pinned on him, but nobody wanted to hire him anymore because he was considered a thief, and Dr. Donald Blake told him so, and thereby shot straight to the top of Dr. Zabo's shit list, so that when, as bad luck would have it, Dr. Zabo finally isolated that Hyde chemical he'd been looking for, drank it, and became Mr. Hyde, this superhuman powerhouse capable of going toe-to-toe with the Hulk.
Yeah, I mean... Strength-wise, he's one of the most powerful villains of the Marvel Universe.
He really is.
Yeah.
And he's also one of the most sadistic.
Yes.
You know, speaking of Roger Stern, you know, that Invasion of Avengers Mansion story.
Beats Jarvis.
Almost to death.
Yeah.
Almost beats Hercules to death.
Yeah.
Come down to it. He was just crazy. Then decides to go after Donald Blake in vengeance for having turned down Calvin Zabo's application for work, and that's how he and Thor end up going at it in this issue.
That's right. And Hyde, again, that Spider-Man story you just mentioned, that's where Hyde in plain sight, my first exposure to Mr. Hyde, and again, it's a classic Spider-Man story where Spider-Man is facing a villain who really has no business fighting. But he finds a way to pull it out in the end and beat him, essentially, which is classic Spidey, essentially. Now, and Hyde will return. Eventually, as we're going to learn, Hyde and Cobra will form their infamous team-up, and they'll become partners for a period of time.
They first appeared in back-to-back issues of Journey into Mystery. It was meant to be.
Now, issue 100, Journey into Mystery. So Thor asks Odin, look, can you make Jane immortal? Because then we can be together. And he's like, nope, I won't make her immortal. Nope. So Odin continues to deny Thor his heart's desire there.
Nope, I'm going to take my ball and go home.
Now, issue 101 begins the legendary Lee Kirby partnership on Thor, continuously, which will run into issue 179 with one interruption. Now, issue 101, Zarko returns, the Tomorrow Man who Murd talked about earlier.
And in the Tales of Asgard backup story, we're introduced to the Rock Trolls and their Lord Geirrodur.
That's right.
Yep, they are pretty know, significant presence in the world of Asgard.
Well done, sir. Well done.
Yeah, for some reason in my masterworks, I actually have the Tales of Asgard in issue 100 reprinted.
For that one issue?
That's the only one that I see.
That's even stranger.
Interesting.
Very strange.
Maybe they didn't fill out the page count. I don't know. Now.
There's no master there.
Now, issue 102, this is something Odin has done more than once to Thor to punish him. He deprives Thor of some of his godly power. And, of course, the problem is that oftentimes Thor has to go into battle.
For that one power.
He doesn't have his full power, essentially. Dear old dad again. Now, issue 102 also in the Tales of Asgard backup is the first appearance of Lady Sif, although she has blonde hair in this issue, not the raven tresses we're more accustomed to.
Raven tresses.
I like that.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, honey. Go ahead, Murt.
Thereby hangs a tale from the old Norse myths.
Yes.
Here we go.
Murt, I knew I could count on you. Go
ahead. Actually I think this might actually have been recounted in the comics somewhere. The reason why she goes from blonde to black-haired, raven-tressed. It's because Loki, at some point, shaves off her hair as a trick or a prank.
What?
And Odin is really pissed at him for this and threatens him with all kinds of terrible punishments.
Which never happens.
He goes, I think, to the dwarves and asks them to produce some wrought metal hair as a replacement. So that black hair of hers is actually a wig made of iron. Fibrous iron. It comes right from the old Eddas.
I read the same. And we should point out that Sif will not reappear until actually Mighty Thor issue 136. And the reason for that is, I'm guessing here, is that they're going to phase Jane Foster out by that point and then make Sif Thor's paramour, because they established that Thor and Sif were kind of, I think, grew up together, and there's always this ties between them. And throughout the Thor comics, Sif is often his long-suffering, you know, warrior by his side, and also is always in love with him, but he doesn't always return that love because sometimes Jane's in the picture. And in fact, and they do that in the movie. That's very much a plot device in the movie. That in both issues,
couple times,
yeah, Sif wants to be with Thor, but he's his eyes are all set on
and
Jane.
Odin even tries to sway him that way
in the second film. Yeah. So a lot of that's really from the comic, essentially. Now, issue 103. I'm sorry, Mark.
One more thing about number 102.
Please.
This is very germane to the upcoming Thor Ragnarok movie. Number 102 in that, I think that same Tales of Asgard backup, is the first appearance of Hela, goddess of the ignoble dead, in the Asgardian cosmology.
Well done, sir. And Hela will try to get Thor's soul on numerous occasions throughout the characters. Is she almost taken with Thor? Am I correct in saying that, or no?
To the extent that a being such as she can be taken, I think she's just drawn to the possibility of
possessing a soul of that kind of power, essentially.
Yeah. Much more attracted to the idea of owning Thor than she is to Thor himself.
Right. Now, issue 103, a very important supporting character in the Mighty Thor's history, the Enchantress, Amora. Murd, begin.
She's kind of a slut.
just tremendous.
Her name is Amora, and she is a practitioner of the mystic arts. She goes around Asgard, basically seducing various mages and wizards. And
she's a powerful sorceress in her own right.
And she adds to her power by learning what these male enchanters can teach her. Yeah. And she also studies underneath Carnilla the Norn Queen, we're eventually told. So, yes, she has most of her magic tricks are funneled towards enhancing her own natural allure.
She's a seductress of the First Order.
Right. She's magic and sex go hand in hand for her, pretty much.
What we should point out, though, is the Enchantress has been developed over time.
Yes, she has.
But no, what I was going to say was she's not always portrayed purely as a villain. Like, there's some complexity to the character. Mm-hmm. And you also sense that in her heart of hearts, she's really in love with Thor. But she feels... She can never possess him, essentially.
And I think she's in love with power even more than she is with him.
I think that's also a fair point.
Yeah.
Now.
Oh, and let's not forget, this is the issue in which Scourge the Executioner also makes his debut.
Go ahead, sir.
Yep. And we first meet him as one of the Enchantress's many male pawns.
Yeah.
Sensei.
His mighty battle axe.
Right. She strings him along throughout. Oh, for years she does this to poor Scourge.
He is an Asgardian, right?
He's half Asgardian.
He's half Asgardian.
Yeah,
okay.
He is half Asgardian and half Jotun, storm giant.
Okay.
And so he's always been kind of an outsider as a result of that. But he's one of the most powerful warriors in Asgard.
Sometimes he'll appear wearing a helmet. Essentially over his face, but oftentimes he'll appear without the helmet.
Yeah.
Essentially. Yeah. And I mentioned my notes here. In the beginning of our episode, Pants, again, wonderful. You played the theme music from the classic 1960s stiff arm moving animated Thor series. And these issues we're looking at right here, 103 and 104, were adapted into animated episodes, which I've seen many times, where they basically take the Kirby art, which I'm sure he got no money for, of course, and they kind of semi-animate them, essentially, and you have, like, out-of-work Shakespearean actors delivering these lines of dialogue. It's fantastic. But have you guys seen those cartoons?
Somewhat, yeah.
Just scattered here and there.
Yeah. Never once.
Oh. I'm not sure I could sit still through a whole one or not.
Oh, they're a scream. Oh, they're...
Yeah, there's something all right.
Plus, I remember as a kid... In the early 80s, they would play them on, I think it was Channel 11.
WPIX.
Yeah,
and, from New York.
And I didn't realize these cartoons were from the 60s when they first appeared. So I'm watching as a little kid, and I love Marvel already, so I was in all of them. And I love watching, even the animation is so crude, even by the standards of the early 1980s.
Yeah.
You know, but I was just in all of them. But as an older man, you realize, my God, like that's Gene Colan art. That's Jack Kirby art, that's Don Heck art, you know, they just lifted it right from, and they would animate like mouths and an arm or something like that. But these stories that we're looking at right now are in there. Now, issue 104, I think is a favorite of mine. All right, Odin is so ticked that Thor will not give up on Jane that Loki convinces him to travel to Midgard to, quote, assert your authority in person. And then furthermore, Odin grants Loki some of his, quote, Odin power and leaves him in charge of Asgard. Loki! The guy he banished into a tree. All right? He's now making him
come out of the tree.
He's now making him the temporary liege of Asgard with some of his power. Now,
what could possibly go wrong?
Yeah. So Loki in his...
Okay, Dad, no problem.
In his mischief, releases Surtur... And Skag, I forgot who Skag is. Mer, do you remember who Skag is?
I don't remember Skag.
Some other demonic entity. And they attack the Earth. So Baldur and Thor and Odin band together, and they defeat Skag and Surtur. And Odin, you know, out of respect for Thor's bravery and his courage, he lets Thor stay in Midgard, but he says his heart is weakened by love because of Jane. These issues were adapted almost in some cases panel for panel into the animated episodes.
Skag is a storm giant, apparently.
Thank you, sir. Issue 105, as Pants mentioned, they show a weekly meeting of the Avengers, where the Avengers meet and Janet Van Dyne the Wasp inquires Thor, like, what about, because Thor says, you know, it's so lucky that you and Hank Pym can go off together, and Janet starts to inquire about his love life, and Hank says, wait a minute, Janet, we don't discuss people's private lives here. So, don't you love how the early years the Wasp is like shown as either pining over clothes she wants to wear, or you know, is it's fascinating the way they portray women in these early stories?
Because
I mean, they only seem to fit them in certain categories, and that's it. It's just a fascinating time capsule.
If Danny were here, I think
she'd be raging.
She'd
right
have
now.
A different word for it.
She'd be raging.
Yeah,
I think you'd have gotten a smack upside the head for that one too.
Well, I didn't write it, but
oh, I know.
Yeah, and he's not. He's not coming out in favor of it. He's just saying it's fascinating.
But hey, at the same time, that was the world, right? That was the culture of that time, and the art of that time, the sort of the pop culture of the time. It manifests itself.
Yeah.
And in that sense, it's a very interesting time capsule, to say the least.
And around this time, according to again comic book DP, Thor also appears in FF 25 and 26 with Hulk versus the Thing, and.
That's the cover where they show the FF against everybody, right? Like, aren't the X-Men in there?
FF 25, yeah. I'm like, pull that up here.
The Avengers.
Oh, yeah. You just see it's this cover right here. As you can take a look at that, that's 25.
Just do me a favor. Just you or me, go to 26, please.
26. All right. Let me do that.
I love when Pants provides himself with a soundtrack. It's fantastic.
Oh, my goodness. And that was, what the heck was that issue number here?
Fantastic Four 26.
The Avengers take over in FF 26. Yep. Yeah, yep. Featuring a galaxy of the world's most thrilling guest stars.
We have to remember that in the early store. Silver Age, more and more, Lee and Kirby and the other artists take pains to start to create that integrated, interlocking universe, essentially. Now, issue 107, first appearance, The Grey Gargoyle. Murd?
A French chemist by the name of Paul-Pierre Duval.
That's it! I've had it.
Oui. Who accidentally discovers a chemical compound that, can cause human flesh to gain the ability to petrify anything it touches. So he rubs this all over his body and turns kind of gray and stone-like, so his body has the properties of stone.
Right.
But it can also imbue other matter with the properties of stone. But unlike the Grey Gargoyle's body itself, that which he imbues with the property of stone does not also have the power of life and locomotion. So if he touches a living being, they won't turn into a Grey Gargoyle themselves. They'll just turn into a stone statue of themselves. The condition is reversible. So the gargoyle doesn't kill his victims. He just immobilizes them, petrifies them temporarily.
What reverses it, though? I forgot. Is it a formula or time?
That I don't remember.
Okay. Because the gargoyle, he appeared in Thor. He appeared in Captain America. He appeared in the Avengers.
Mm-hmm. He was a master. I think he was part of that same team that included Mr. Hyde.
And I remember that there was a Matt Fraction Iron Man story where he used the Grey Gargoyle to a terrifying degree. Did you read that story, Pants?
Does it ring a bell?
I think the gargoyle actually immobilizes a large proportion of Paris or something like that. Like it's actually horrifying. This is a villain that's been around since the early 60s. I'm not sure of his status right now since that Fraction story, but again, a lot of major villains are introduced in Journey into Mystery and the Mighty Thor in the Silver Age. Now, as I mentioned earlier, you talk about Odin having a snit. And also the integration of the Marvel Universe. Issue 108, Doctor Strange has been wounded. And he needs the help of one of the world's foremost surgeons, which is Donald Blake. And he submits to surgery, and Blake is trying to save his life. And Odin is so ticked off that Thor is choosing Midgard over Asgard. He knocks at the electricity in Manhattan. While Blake's in the middle of this life-saving surgery. Now, Blake still saves Strange's life, but Odin's a dick, man. I mean, he's just...
Sure is.
God, I mean, imagine this was your dad. Like, imagine like asking the guy for the car or something like that. I mean, it's going to be... What kind of hoops do you have to jump through?
Yeah.
I mean, it's... Woo! Now, issue 109.
Before we talk about
please, sir.
One more quick note about number 107, actually. That was, in addition to being the first appearance of the Grey Gargoyle, it also introduced in the Tales of Asgard backup the Carnilla the Norn Queen.
Go ahead, sir.
Mentioned her a couple of times already. She is, she's the mightiest sorceress, female magic user in all of Asgard. You know, more mighty by far than the Enchantress, because she's the one who taught the Enchantress what she knows.
Would you say Loki's are only equal, probably?
The two of them have worked together. Since Loki actually was dependent on her, as we'll see in a story a little bit further on when the Wrecker is introduced, Loki actually had to go to her for additional power at some point, so she might actually be the superior of Loki, but she's not quite the schemer that Loki is.
And we should mention she's romantically obsessed with Baldur the Brave, and that's a recurring plot line as well.
Yes.
Well done, sir. Issue 109 is a pretty famous cover. It's Thor versus Magneto. And again, bringing other elements of the Marvel Universe into Thor's world. The X-Men, of course, also appear in this story. This is the X-Men in their early blue and gold uniforms, the original team.
Yeah, you see Quicksilver in his green uniform on the cover.
Oh, Masters of Evil.
Yeah.
Exactly. Well done, sir. So, once again, Thor is more and more, the creators are emphasizing he is part of the wider Marvel Universe. That is that tapestry that's unfolding here before the eyes of the readers. Now, issue 110 begins the partnership between Mr. Hyde and the Cobra, who act as agents for Loki. We mentioned earlier how Loki will often recruit or manipulate proxies to lash out against Thor for him, and Cobra and Mr. Hyde act in that capacity. In this case, issue 110, Odin, this will not be the last time, banishes Thor from Asgard. You know, because once again, he's displeased with Thor's affection for Midgard and, of course, his passion for Jane Foster. Now, in issue 111, Odin shows his more merciful side. Jane is in dire danger, and Odin does help her and help save her life. So Odin's a lot... I don't want to get the impression that Odin's all bad. He has his more benignly fatherly moments, so to speak. Now, issue 112 was a classic. It's the first Thor versus Hulk confrontation, but it's kind of told as a flashback. It's an interesting plot device. Lee comes up with a story, Lee and Kirby, where Thor comes upon kids who are arguing, who's stronger, Thor or the Hulk? And Thor tells the kids, well, I met the Hulk once. And he tells them a tale from the past about Thor and the Hulk met in battle, but it was inconclusive. There was no true winner. Now, that issue also, it's Tales of Asgard Backup, is the origin of Loki, which also appears in the classic Bring on the Bad Guys, Fireside Edition, which, again, magnificent Kirby art, shows Odin and his army defeating. Now, wait a minute. In the story, they're not shown as frost giants. Are they shown as storm giants in that story? Do you recall?
I don't think I've read it.
Okay. So, I'll have to check that. But they show Loki taken in by Odin as a child, and they show Loki scheming as he grows up as a kid, as an older kid with Thor, and they're setting the stage for that Loki's burning jealousy when it comes to Thor. I can't emphasize again how good the Tales of Asgard stuff is. It's magnificent Lee Kirby stuff. Now, issue 113, Thor temporarily reveals his identity to Jane Foster. That doesn't last. Eventually, that's wiped away. Issue 114, pretty major baddie in the Marvel Universe. And one who's crossed over into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. First appearance, the Absorbing Man. Murd?
Okay. Carl Crusher Creel.
Yes.
Your basic tough-as-nails bad guy, you know, which can be literal in his case, as we'll see. Mm-hmm. He's a criminal, and he was in prison, and Loki chose him as another one of his proxies, or cat's paws, to strike at his brother Thor. Offers him an Asgardian herbal potion to drink, which will give him the ability to absorb the physical properties of any substance he touches. And he happens to be wearing a ball and chain at the time, so it mystically gains the same properties that he does, so that it can absorb the toughness of iron or the fluidity of water, and so on. His power set has been pretty loosely interpreted by some writers over the years. Sometimes he can absorb the properties of energy. Sometimes he can absorb human intelligence. You know, sky's kind of the limit. But usually it's just he touches a physical substance and he gains its properties. And he's often defeated. He's not very bright, you see, is Crusher Creel. So he's often defeated by being tricked into touching something that's awfully brittle or vulnerable. And then he's like, he's defeated that way.
But he's probably one of the most powerful supervillains in the Marvel Universe.
Potentially, yeah, depending on how this power of his is used.
Yeah. And he gives Thor a run for his money. Of course, as you know, Shane, he appeared at Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah.
I mean, they interpreted him, the character, in a different way, but he has the same power set.
Yeah.
Essentially. So it was really neat to see him when they first appeared. I remember Ricky said, it's the Absorbing Man.
Mm-hmm.
So
they did him really well.
Yeah, I've been pleased with the way they've crossed over characters in that show.
Yeah, so that was fun to see. Of course, he'll later end up... Is Titania become his girlfriend?
His wife, in fact.
His wife, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yep, then they meet during Secret Wars.
Secret Wars, that's right. He's one of the villains who's recruited by the Beyonder. That's interesting. It was an interesting array of villains they chose for the Secret Wars. Very interesting. Now... All right. Issue 116 is a big deal in the Silver Age, the Trial of the Gods. And this is where Odin demands Loki and Thor compete against each other because he's grown weary of their constant conflict, which he feels has not been sanctioned by him. Again, the massive ego of Odin, all right? So he wants them to sort of duke it out in this battle of physical skills and wits. To see who's superior.
He doesn't like that they're arguing with each other because he didn't sanction it.
Well, it's like a... I may be remembering it partially incorrectly, but I remember correctly, he's grown weary of this conflict that is being done without his permission, kind of done privately. So he wants them to... It's kind of like, go off school grounds and take care of this. Okay, off campus, guys. So Loki, of course, will cheat because he will get access to the Norn Stones. Murd, do you remember what those are? Sorry, I caught you in mid-mastication there, sir.
I'm sorry.
That didn't sound quite right.
That's why I said it. But he knows what it means.
Indeed. I have a cookie. Well, yeah, I remember that there are powerful mystical objects that Loki can wreak havoc with. And Norns are... They're a group of sort of like druids, I guess. The Norns are the Asgardian Fates. That's right.
That's right, yep.
Yes, Urd, Skuld, and Verdandi by name. But it's a trio of seeresses with great insight into cosmic destiny. And so I guess the Norn Stones are connected to them. But yes, I don't remember what exactly the Norn Stones did.
Murd, how's that cookie?
Very tasty.
Yeah? What brand?
It's a Wawa chocolate chip.
They're opening a Wawa near me. I'm excited. Anyway,
They're spreading. Wawa's a convenience store chain for those who,
you know,
we're not speaking baby talk.
You just made it sound like a venereal disease.
These weird
but anyway,
names.
Yeah. Now, well, it's the Lenny Lenape word for goose. That's why a goose appears on their logo. You can see this, right?
Talk about edification.
Lenny, say that again. Lenny Lenape.
Yeah, it's a local American Indian
tribe.
Yeah,
it's speechless.
Okay. That one I did not know.
Now.
Yes, he speaks us because he wants us to hurry up.
All right, now. Issue 117.
Talking to the mic.
Issue 117. One of the things I love about the Thor and the Silver Age is the hyperbole of the titles. Into the blaze of battle. And Thor ends up fighting communists again. I want to say in Vietnam this time. Several Marvel heroes ended up in Vietnam. Iron Man ended up in Vietnam, of course. Captain America ended up in Vietnam at one point. It was in the news, so
yeah.
Always trying to be topical, which
is part
of Marvel's motif. Now, issue 118, I think, is an important one for Murd. The first appearance of the Destroyer.
It says here, Murd, please begin.
The ultimate weapon of the Allfather, held in reserve for when he must take down truly dreadful cosmic beings, and it's a weapon he can use as God against God. He has it sealed away in a temple someplace, and I think Loki is trying to seek it out to use it as a weapon against Thor, of course. But it's basically this big enchanted suit of armor. You can't wear it, but you can project your life essence, your astral form, into it and animate it that way. But it can only be used for destructive purposes.
And I thought it was brilliantly rendered in the first Thor film.
Oh, my
wow.
Lord. That is one of the most perfect transfers
yeah.
of a comic character to film that I've ever seen. It's a big part of the reason why Thor remains my favorite Marvel solo hero.
It's one of my
franchise.
Favorites as well. And as you mentioned, various entities have found themselves in the Destroyer. Some willing and some not willing,
mm-hmm.
I believe.
Yep, and they can't always control their actions once they're in there because the Destroyer's programming to destroy tends to overwhelm one's will.
So,
we eventually learn, as via retcon, that Odin intended this thing to be used to defend Asgard against the Celestials when they arrived to pass judgment on planet Earth.
Magnificent. Of course, the Celestials are a classic Kirby concept from when he returned to Marvel in the 1970s.
A classic Kirby concept.
Yes, spelled with K's, all K's.
We love our alliteration here.
Indeed. Now, issue 119, the Tales of Asgard here is very important. Introduces some of my favorite supporting characters in the world of Mighty Thor, which is the Warriors Three. Fandral the Dashing, Hogan the Grim, and Volstagg the Voluminous. Now, Murd, I know you wanted to say some things about the Warriors Three in particular.
I wanted to say just that I'm sort of reminded of Thor and the Warriors Three by the four of us sitting around this table.
Ha-ha!
Now,
I don't even know who's who in that situation.
I'm not going to... To even try to cast that
yeah,
movie.
It's not.
Lately, I'm eating a lot.
Now,
it's been a July 4th weekend, so, yeah.
Great concepts by Lee and Kirby. Basically, they created sort of...
The Three Musketeers.
Yeah, the Three Musketeers. Exactly, Three Musketeers, thank you.
And Asgard.
And, of course...
Original characters, not from mythology at
they
all.
They are original characters, yes. And they're sort of comrades-in-arms for Thor. Each has a very distinctive personality. Fandral is basically Errol Flynn. Essentially.
Exactly.
From Captain Blood and Robin Hood and so forth. Hogan the Grim is almost an Asiatic-type character in the way he's rendered. He comes from a different realm in Asgard. He's not. I don't think he's Asgardian, actually. He comes from a different community, if I remember correctly. Am I correct in saying that? Right?
Yes, he does have his own distinct tribe.
Yeah.
I think there are a couple of stories that hinge on that.
And, of course, Volstagg, who is... one of my favorite Thor support or any supporting character, because Lee and other writers have had so much fun because Volstagg is this obese, vainglorious, boastful, yet ultimately loyal comrade of Thor. And Thor often comments how Volstagg probably just wants to get away from his wife and kids when he goes off on these adventures. He often refers to himself as the Lion of Asgard. And he often will stumble and like accidentally topple and crush opponents because of his huge girth. He'll find ways to avoid combat in any way he possibly can. And, of course, his appetite, his mirth is legendary. Is it Ray Stevenson plays him in the films?
I don't know the actor's name, but yeah.
Obviously, he's not as big as...
No.
Because no one could be.
But he does a pretty good job.
I think he does a great job capturing like the persona of Volstagg. Because Volstagg ultimately is brave. When the poop hits the fan, he will not abandon you. But after that
All the things we've said in this episode, poop in the fan is what you came up with.
Of course.
And it is Ray Stevenson.
Thank you, sir.
I love in the second Thor movie where they show some of the kids at the one bar or something where they're hanging out celebrating. And it was a nice touch to throw some of that in there.
His massive family, his incredible, insatiable appetite, for not only for food but for life in general. All the different nicknames he gives himself as he recounts all these battles he's in, whether they're in his imagination or not. But a stalwart comrade in arms of Thor, of course, and often used as comic relief by Lee and subsequent writers. I loved in the first Thor film, is there a Renaissance fair in town? Yeah, we got Robin Hood, Xena, and Jackie Chan. It's so perfect because, you know, Fandral basically is Errol Flynn. He's Robin Hood, essentially. And now they had different actors portraying him, but I thought both were great.
The one who portrayed him in the second movie, if I remember right, was supposed to portray him in the first movie. That didn't work out, so they brought in another guy, and then something changed from the B in the second movie anyway. Because the one in the first movie couldn't do the second movie.
Right.
So it was an interesting little article.
They both worked.
It was cool.
But the way they were, I think Fandral especially just stepped right out of the comic, the way he was portrayed in the film. Now, that Warriors 3 in Tales of Asgard story also is entitled Ragnarok is Coming. Now, of course, Ragnarok is the twilight of the gods, and in Norse mythology, that's the end of Asgard, essentially, right? Where all the gods will be destroyed, I think in battle with themselves, essentially.
Well, with Loki and his demonic offspring.
Yeah.
And so he rallies together a bunch of monsters and such.
And Kirby alludes in these stories that Loki will be the source of Ragnarok, and that Ragnarok is coming, as you mentioned, Murd. Marvel uses Ragnarok throughout the whole Thor comic. In fact, I think even, I want to say when they ended the first volume, I think they actually have Ragnarok happen, if I remember correctly.
You mean around the time of Heroes Reborn?
I don't remember. Someone can correct me on the forums.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Yeah, they were sort of flirting with it, but they're always flirting with it.
True.
I'm
thinking of before the Straczynski run, when the Asgardians all end up in mortal form, they don't remember who they are.
Oh, okay. Was that the journey into when they revived the Journey into Mystery?
No. That was when they started Thor over again with Straczynski as the.
Oh, okay.
Writer.
So much later.
Yeah, we'll get it. When we continue other Thor spotlights, we'll get into that in more detail.
Right.
Because I'm only half remembering at the moment. I apologize for that. Now, all right. Now. Issue 120 I thought was fun because, again, Lee and Kirby always try to put Marvel in the real world so it's relatable. So they have Thor go to Pittsburgh when they actually still produce steel. And he goes to a foundry although I didn't think Mjolnir needed it, to repair his hammer. And there's images of steel workers looking on in awe as Thor is, you know, at the foundry, like, working on Mjolnir, essentially. So classic Lee Kirby. They acknowledge that the Norn stones were used by Loki to cheat during the Trial of the Gods, so he didn't really win that. I only mention issue 121 because I love the Marvel hyperbole. The power, the passion, the pride. And I love these titles because, again, they're part of that over-the-top grandeur that more and more seeps into Marvel's take on Thor. Now, issue 124 is a classic. The grandeur and the glory. And so they bring Now, Hercules has already been introduced in the Marvel Universe.
Yes, actually, in Journey into Mystery Annual, which came out late 1965.
That's an oversight on my part. Please continue, sir.
I don't have any more than that. It's just that's Hercules's, the Marvel Hercules's first appearance was in that annual.
And then, of course, he'll later be a member of the Avengers. And this version of Hercules has had a long history.
Oh, quite a distinguished career apart from Thor in the Marvel Universe.
Yes, in the Marvel Universe.
And it was called When Titans Clash, the annual story.
Thanks, honey. Now, what happens here is, so Zeus sends Hercules to Earth, because Hercules is in battle with Atlas, or Ares, I forgot which one, and Zeus says, why don't you go to Earth to take a look at what's going on over there, and Hercules goes to Earth, and a movie producer wants to put him in the films, and he's producing, performing different feats of strength and daring do. And in issue 125, now this is the last issue of Journey into Mystery. That's going to switch over, same numbering, to the Mighty Thor. Marvel often did this once they broke out of their distribution straitjacket. They start to produce more titles.
So Tales of Suspense went to Cap, right?
Tales of Suspense broke up into Captain America and Iron Man. Oh, it's the numbering.
I'm sorry.
The numbering is Cap. I apologize. Yes.
Did Tales to Astonish go to the Hulk?
Yes.
Okay. Just because I know, like, there's there's Hulk 1 through
and
6.
And Strange
then
Tales
Hulk
went to Doctor Strange.
Doctor Strange. Okay.
Yep. Thank you, sir.
I just love that kind of thing with the number.
Yep. It's also for collectors. It's good to know because it can be confusing if you don't know.
Where's Thor 85?
Yeah, exactly.
No Thor 85.
Now, issue 125, this is also an animated episode. Thor is forced to undergo the Ritual of Steel because Odin is again displeased with him, and he orders Thor to fight all the warriors of Asgard at the same time. And Baldur the Brave goes to Odin. He goes, sire, I can't fight Thor. And he goes, Thor, my friend who is more than brother to me. I remember that from the animated episode. Classic hyperbole. And, of course, Thor beats them all. And he goes back to Midgard. And Hercules is making moves on Jane. And Jane is so ticked off with Donald Blake and Thor, although she still doesn't know they're the same. And she decides to make Thor jealous, and Thor sees Hercules and Jane like having lunch together or something like that. something pedestrian. And of course a Donnybrook ensues.
A Donnybrook, yes. You say.
Wow. And
Mighty Thor 126. They switch the masthead, the same numbering. Whom the gods would destroy. This is a very famous cover.
Yes, it is,
Where Thor, classic Kirby, like the big fist coming at you. And Thor and Hercules locked in pugilism, so to speak.
I have a vague feeling that this was also sort of redone with Thor and Beta Ray Bill at some point, that cover image. I mean, I could be completely off base with that. Probably in back to local news.
I mean, you'd have to check that. I mean, Simonson certainly knew his history, so that's very possible. Now, eventually, of course, Thor and Hercules come to an understanding, as the Marvel heroes always do, and they end up in these fist fights. And Jane, you know, tells Thor, I was just trying to make you jealous. You know, I really love you, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, they go on. Now, issue 127 is a classic Kirby cover. In fact, I'm sorry, I should have sent it to you, Shane. I apologize.
Oh,
the Hammer and the Holocaust. Kirby kind of recreates the Pieta, and he shows Odin holding a mortally wounded Thor, essentially, in his arms. Classic Kirby cover. That's issue 127.
Boy, I'm amazed. Issue 338 is the cover with Thor and Beta Ray Bill.
Okay. You're right on the money there.
Thinking,
right on the money. Fairly close, honey. It's not the exact replica of it, but it's probably in the spirit. Now, that Tales of Asgard issue from Thor 127, the meaning of Ragnarok. And Odin is explaining to the assembled Asgardians, and this goes into issue 128 as well, that Loki will be the cause of Ragnarok. I mean, you can hear Deemer screaming, "Just kill him!" Now, but then there wouldn't be a fun story, now would there?
I mean, it's ridiculous. Why would you let?
That's one of his Deemer's favorite words. Ridiculous, isn't it?
This is so preposterous.
Well done. Well done. Now, I should point out that Kirby, who is clearly well versed in Norse mythology, when he creates the new gods, when he moves over to DC, and I've read some background on this, it's clear that there were concepts he was thinking of that he may have wanted to bring into Thor, but he was so tired of Marvel's policies, he didn't want Marvel to have ownership of these ideas. So if you read the first issue of The New Gods, have you read that issue?
It's been a long time, yeah. But I have read, okay. I've read it.
Mm-hmm. But when it opens, he's talking about battles between the old gods that ends in their destruction. And if you read between the lines, you can tell he's probably writing about the Asgardians, basically.
Yeah, okay, I can see that, absolutely.
And then it carries over into The New Gods. It's a fascinating back history about how Kirby leaves Marvel. And you know, he was tired of giving them content because he wasn't getting compensation for them or credit. So many historians think he brought some of these ideas and incorporated them into The New Gods over at DC, essentially. But Ragnarok comes up again and again. And again, Kirby, through Tales of Asgard, shows his love for that mythology. Now, issue 128 through 130, Thor teams up with Hercules. They introduce Pluto, the Olympian god of the underworld Hades. And Thor aids Hercules in his struggles against Pluto. Issue 130. Now, starting with issue 131, the Mighty Thor comic really starts to take a shift into what I call Kirby cosmic grandeur. He starts to put Thor more into outer space. Mm-hmm.
Leaving the whole human frame of reference behind,
exactly.
More than just about any other superhero comic had ever attempted.
I'll read here from my notes. Kirby elevated Thor from a superhero in a Viking costume to a warrior god of mythic and cosmic proportions. As the series progressed and its epic spoken grandeur increased, Lee and Kirby wove Norse myth into the fabric of the emerging Marvel Universe. And even furthermore, as they get into the 130s, as Merge said, he's off Earth. He's away from Asgard. He's into the galaxy. He's deep into the universe, essentially. And for me, this is some of the greatest artwork of Kirby's whole Marvel career. Basically. Now, issue 131, we begin with a new alien race. How do you say that, Murd?
Rigelians.
All right, the Rigelians. Go ahead.
Okay. Also called the colonizers.
That's
of Rigel.
Right. That's right.
That's the name for the ruling regime. Yeah. They are, well, or the agents thereof, anyway. They go out into space and scout out suitable worlds to be kidnapped back to the Rigel system via the Rigelian space lock technology. And made a part of the Rigelians' little cottage empire.
They're diminutive beings, aren't they?
They're fairly small, yeah. With largish heads.
They wear helmets around their heads.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, a great Kirby design. They're
yes,
sort
it
of
is.
Pale yellowish skin. And they're a colonizer who comes to Earth to scout it out for possible absorption into the empire is Tana Nile.
A female Rigelian.
Yes.
Who pretends to be Jane Foster's roommate. That's right.
She's disguised as a human, yes.
Yep.
And eventually, Thor, well, by the example of the nobility of Thor and I guess her friendship with Jane Foster, she decides to let Earth go and allow it to retain its autonomy.
And I think she's a recurring character.
Yes.
She appears again, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
she becomes kind of a mainstay of cosmic stories.
And Thor is recruited by the Rigelians to enter into the Black Galaxy. And issue 132, and they give Thor a companion. I think this is a fascinating Marvel character, the Recorder. You know what I'm talking about here, Murd?
Oh, sure.
Who's the Recorder?
They're humanoid androids. They're basically just glorified recording equipment with arms and legs. There are many of them. They accompany the various colonizers out into space. And
almost like an archivist recording.
Yeah, exactly.
You see, yeah.
Yep. And so each of them has a serial number. The one that accompanies Thor on this journey is called number 211.
And those who are X-Men fans, if you recall the Dark Phoenix saga. As the Watcher is in the climactic part of that story, is watching the end of the Dark Phoenix, there's a Recorder standing next to him who the Watcher is discussing the significance of the events that they're observing. Now, Shane, if you go to my Thor 133, please. I think this is one of Kirby's greatest concepts, just being so far out. Ego, the living planet.
Behold.
A planet with a face and a beard. But it's awesome. Murd, go ahead.
That kind of covers it. I mean, it's every single molecule on that planet is a part of the same organism. It's described by Kirby as a sentient living bioverse. And it's
classic Kirby.
It's if you've ever read the first appearance of the all-new, all-different X-Men, where they fight Krakoa, the island that walks like a man,
right.
It's the same thing on a planetary scale. The whole world is all part of the same collective intelligence.
So if you land on Ego and Ego perceives you as a threat, like antibodies will spring up from the terrain to fight you, but it's all controlled by this one entity.
Mm-hmm.
And we did our Fantastic Four John Byrne spotlight. We talked about how Byrne brought the FF to Ego and how they had to descend into the bowels of the planet, the crushing pressure. And so forth. It's a great concept.
Yeah. And when Kirby renders it, he starts playing around with those special, I don't even know what word to use, those sort of photo reproduction graphics that he used.
Actually, thank you, Murr. Perfect subject. Shane, go to my collage page that I sent you.
Ba-boom.
And that shows Thor and the Recorder, who becomes a close companion of Thor and almost has human-like characteristics.
Mm-hmm. Yep. As I recall from his entry in Ohatmu, he's one of the very few recorders that the Rigelians allowed to retain his memory.
And that was at Thor's request.
Right. They usually get their minds wiped after every assignment, but not this one. Number 211 witnessed such spectacles of cosmic grandeur and glory that he was allowed to retain his memories thereof.
But the image Shane has on the screen, one of the most cutting-edge aspects for me of Kirby's art in the Silver Age was he would use collages. The Fantastic Four, for example, in the classic issue 51, This Man, This Monster, when Reed enters the negative zone, he does another issues of Fantastic Four, and also here in Thor, Kirby incorporates multimedia to create these just, to use Shane's vernacular, these fantastical worlds, and so these dreamscapes. I mean, it's amazing. And it just, no one else was doing this in comics. This has to be emphasized at this time.
I'm thinking, great space coast.
Well done, sir. But so, I'm so envious of readers of that time, Pants, who were there when it was happening. Open a book like that. They plunked down their 12 cents, and that's what they got. I mean, man.
Oh, God, 12 cents.
Talk about your talk about your money's worth. Oh, quite a jump from to $3.99, huh? Now, we should mention that the Eagle Living Planet isn't necessarily evil, per se.
Nope, no more than Galactus.
Yeah, and he, we're going to talk about, because Galactus is going to show up soon in these stories, and Ego will play a role in that as well. Issue 134 is all Murd. It's the first appearance, I think, of a fascinating Kirby concept.
Oh, yes.
The High Evolutionary and the Knights of Wundagore. Go ahead, Murd.
Which had been kind of foreshadowed subtly in the couple of issues leading into it. We meet a couple of his new men before we meet the High Evolutionary himself.
Who are anthropomorphic animals who ride these...
Oh, evolved animals.
Yes. Yep. Right, they ride these mechanical steeds, essentially.
Yep. Right, right. His name was Dr. Herbert Edgar Wyndham, and he was a biologist who was fascinated by the study of evolution. And he set up shop on Mount Wundagore, which ties him in with Quicksilver
and
the Scarlet Witch.
It's like a Balkan nation.
Yes. Basically. Well, in Transia, yes. Transia is the tiny little... And it's a kind of a nexus of black magic because the elder demon Thon is entombed beneath it. But science meets this black magic
science.
Then because...
Science!
Exactly, because the High Evolutionary sets up his laboratory there, and that's actually where the twins of Magneto, Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch, are born. And one
of Marvel history and Wundagore.
That's also where the Puppet Master's magic clay comes from.
Yes.
The twins are actually raised by one of the High Evolutionary's experiments, one of his first evolved new men, as he calls them. The very first... Right, Bova, an evolved cow.
Yep.
Yes. The very first one he ever evolved was his pet dog. Then he also, there was also Porga, Sir Porga, and Count Tagar, who we are introduced to in the pages of the last couple of issues of Thor before this one. They're a pig and a tiger, respectively. And they're more human than a lot of the other animals.
And actually, when you think about when Kirby goes over to DC and does Commandy,
yes.
He continues that theme with human-like animals.
100%. Yes, this is definitely like a proto-commandy kind of thing happening here. But so he evolves these animals, and when he discovers that Porga and Tagar suffer the resentment of some of his other experiments, he decides not to make them quite as human. What are you laughing at now?
When you said something, I text Pants with, Mulva!
We're falling apart, ladies and gentlemen.
Anyway, he's a scientist who specializes in evolution, and he manages to evolve himself to a near godlike state. So it's only fitting that this self-made god of science should encounter this god of ancient mythology.
Because the High Evolutionary, as they develop the character, he's not really human anymore, correct?
No, he isn't.
Like, inside that armor, is he even a man anymore?
He's kind of up and down. Okay. There are times when he becomes a gorilla.
Doesn't he fight Galactus at some point?
He does become powerful. He's basically sentient energy inside of that armor at times. But it's kind of a winding way he walks. His evolutionary state fluctuates. He's been like a gorilla inside of that suit at other times.
Fantastic. Now, issue 136 is actually an important issue in Thor's history. Odin finally relents and he agrees to make Jane immortal so she can live among the gods. But this is a great story by Liam Kirby. Jane can't cope. She can't handle being an Asgardian. And Odin sends her back to Midgard. He wipes her mind of the whole experience. And then they bring Sif back into it. And Thor and Sif begin to rekindle the romance. They kind of phase Jane out of the book for a while. She'll pop up once in a while in the future, but she's more or less gone. So whereas Jane was such a mainstay of the Donald Blake Thor persona and their sort of their private world, they move her out. And I'm just guessing it, but it may be in keeping of with the Gesundheit, the fact that Thor is now it's so grand now in its scope, it's so epic, and he's now out in space. Probably not a lot of room for Jane in that sense. So they kind of move her out. Although she'll return eventually. Now, issue 137 is the first appearance of Ulic, a troll, correct, Murray?
Oh, yes.
Go ahead.
He's just one of the biggest and baddest of the trolls. He's kind of like the Clubber Lang of the troll set. Call goes out from Garador, king of the trolls, to find a champion to take Thor down, and he volunteers. He's huge. He's got these big, basically brass knuckle things he wears on his hands. They're pounders, I think they're called. Like metal bands he wears around his hands, and he uses those as striking weapons. And he fights Thor.
Yes.
He's really not that complicated a character.
But he'll pop up.
A lot, yes.
A lot, yeah. Now, issue 140, Kang the Conqueror shows up manipulating a being called the Growing Man.
Yes, he's a stimuloid, which is a kind of android increases in physical size and these growth spurts are stimulated by the absorption of kinetic energy. Ooh. So basically, the more and the harder you hit him, the bigger he will grow.
And Kang, of course, is using him as an agent, essentially. Again, we often forget how powerful Kang is.
Yeah.
And again, I think the Avengers Forever story does such a wonderful job of really capturing, you know, just the grandeur of Kang as a villain. We mentioned how Loki will use agents. Issue 142, the Super Skrull we've talked about before in our Fantastic Four spotlights. Loki's using him as a proxy against Thor. So there's a long line. We mentioned Cobra, Mr. Hyde, Xandu, and now the Super Skrull being used as pawns of Loki, essentially. Now, issue 143, back to the origins of Marvel Comics. Such a cherished issue of mine. Again, it's one of the first Thor stories I ever wrote. The introduction of the Enchanters, who were powerful sorcerers who tried to overtake Asgard. This is one of my first exposures to Kirby artwork. Shane, if you could go back to Thor 143 splash page.
Already
please.
Done. Johnny on the spot over here.
Wow! I never thought the mighty Thor would come waltzing in here to slurp a soda that way. Even a thunder god may feel the pangs of thirst. From now on, that drink's to be known as my Asgard special. Alas, I find I have no earthly corner of the realm upon my person. But if that will permit me to charge yon frothy drink, forget it, mister, it's on the house. And then the kids are asking to tell them stories of Asgard. But what I loved about this was, it's classic Marvel. Well, this is why I think Marvel was so popular in the Silver Age. You have a superhero coming in, a god basically, to have a soda. And I remember when Wade was writing Captain America, he did a tribute to this story. Cap and Thor are in like at a restaurant, and Thor orders like a root beer float or something, and Cap says, just go with it, to the guy who's behind the counter. But these are the touches that made Marvel, I think, so special in the 1960s. That they were trying to remind us, this could be in your world. Like, you could be go in your favorite soda shop and Thor shows up to have a drink, basically. Yeah. And that's what I think gave Marvel such a foothold in comics that it grew from, essentially. I should also mention, by the way, in this issue, inking by Bill Everett. Now, for much of Lee Kirby's run, Vince Coletta inks Thor. Now, for those who are really into Kirby's art, there's some really controversial and very passionate views on Vince Coletta's inking of Kirby. Pants may be familiar with some of this controversy, for example. Some people feel that Coletta did Kirby's pencils a disservice, because Coletta had a reputation for being a very fast inker, so he was always in demand because he got work done quickly under deadlines and so forth. But some people feel that he did the pencil a disservice by his fast inking. Like, he'd obfuscate details they'd put in there. I remember reading that John Buscema couldn't stand Coletta's inks, for example.
I've heard other bad things about him, too, but...
But other people, are fans of his work. I'm not saying one or the other. I'm just presenting you with what some of the opinions are out there about Coletta. I do know from what I've read, though, that Kirby really liked Everett as an inker. And I remember Bill Everett was a living master when he created the Submariner. I mean, he was, unfortunately, right near the end of his life. Everett died in 1973. He smoked and drank heavily through much of his life. So he's inking here. Marvel brought him back. They gave him work, which was to their credit. And he was penciling. He was inking. He was inking Kirby in some of these issues of Thor. Now, issue 148 is the first appearance of the Wrecker. Murd, what's the significance of the Wrecker?
Oh, I'll be happy to declaim on that at length. But let me jump back to number 145 quick here, because that's the end of the Tales of Asgard backup.
That's right.
Series.
Thank you for reminding me.
Which was actually replaced by the Inhumans as a second feature in Thor for until issue number 152, and then the backups just ceased altogether.
Yeah.
So the end of an era, you might say.
Well done, sir. Well done.
The Wrecker. Okay, so here's another intersection of human and Asgardian might. So the Wrecker was a guy named Dirk Garthwaite. He was just a burglar. His trademark was to take a crowbar with him. He had worked construction until he was fired for his temper tantrums. And so he took this crowbar along, and he would wreck the sites of his robberies as sort of his calling card. One day, he broke into a hotel room where Loki, who was temporarily on the outs with Odin and was marooned on Midgard.
In a flop house, yeah. Okay. Yep,
and he had to, as I mentioned earlier, he had to go crawling to Carnilla, the Norn Queen, his sometime ally, to provide him with extra Asgardian power. But before Carnilla could arrive to give him this, the Wrecker broke in and brained Loki, the trickster god, with a crowbar. And then Carnilla flashed into the hotel room because the Wrecker decided spontaneously, hey, check out this guy's fancy headdress. I think I'm just going to try this on. So it's dark in there. Carnilla zaps in, says, oh, you're wearing the horned hat. You must be Loki. Okay, zap. There you go. Asgardian power. Knock yourself out. And she teleports out again. So that's how this... this stumble bum, this Bronx burglar ends up with the power of an Asgardian god.
And he becomes very powerful.
Yes, yeah. And his crowbar, similar to Carl Creel's wrecking ball getting his absorbing powers, the Wrecker's crowbar becomes as strong and indestructible as he is. And he goes on this major crime spree around New York, and only the Thor shows up to try to stop him, and the Wrecker basically beats him to death with his enchanted crowbar.
And in fact, at issue 150, Hela tries to claim Thor's soul because he's so near death as a consequence of that confrontation. Now, of course, Thor is able to prevent that from happening, and he goes on to claim victory. But it's a reminder, the Wrecker is a bad, bad mother fudger. I mean, he's somebody you don't want to mess with when he has that enchanted crowbar. And then, of course, later on, they'll form the Wrecking Crew. They don't appear in here, but...
Right.
Down the road a little bit. So, and they're all in the Secret Wars story back in the 80s as well.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Now, issue 151, we mentioned how you could get trapped in the Destroyer and out of control, but Sif ends up trapped in the armor of the Destroyer, and she's in jeopardy there. Issue 154 is the first appearance of Mangog. Murd, do you know any key details about him?
Okay, I mentioned earlier that there was a second tribe of Asgardians called the Vanir.
Yes.
This is where they come into play, because Mangog is the living embodiment of the sheer hatred of, quote, a billion billion souls of the Vanir, who were apparently exterminated by Odin millennia earlier.
Good old Odin.
Yeah, continues to be a dick.
And genocide.
So this Mangog creature arose from their cries for vengeance, and it's one of the most powerful, unstoppable beings in all the cosmos. Loki, of course, lets it free. And so Mangog immediately makes a beeline for that oversword thing you mentioned earlier.
Yes, if it's pulled from its sheath, can summon Ragnarok.
Right, yeah. So Thor has to stave it off. And I think finally Odin solves the problem by just resurrecting the Vanir. Whose hatred fueled Mangog's existence. If you could have just done that millennia earlier, this whole mess could have been averted, of course. But so by doing this, the Vanir, since they were alive again, suddenly weren't that angry or feeling hatred. So Mangog, being the personification of their hatred, dwindled down to tiny size and was easily captured in a bell jar or something, and thus passed the threat of Mangog.
But up to that point, it was one of the most powerful and deadly threats Thor ever faced.
Yep, and actually, that his battle with it went on for like 3 or 4
yeah,
issues.
Yeah, it's lengthy. Issue 155. We referenced this before. It's Carnilla and her obsession with Baldur, and she tries to basically capture Baldur, and so he can live with her in her realm. Essentially, she's and Simons will pick up that plot line as well when he's writing Thor on the 1980s. Now, issue 158 and 159 are very important because this explains what or who was Donald Blake?
Yeah, which I never knew this.
Yes.
I never knew this either.
So
I did.
Of course you did.
Issue, issue 159 is known as The Answer at Last. And in issue 158, Donald Blake is wondering, like, who am I? Am I Donald Blake? Am I Thor? And
who am I?
It's Shaney. It's Odin reveals that Donald Blake was never an actual separate human being. Donald Blake, basically, when Thor was younger, he had no humility. He ended up in tavern brawls, and he was, you know, boastful and vainglorious and so forth. And Odin wanted to teach his son humility befitting a king, although I think Odin needs a lesson in humility as well. But anyway.
That's it.
So, especially if you're reading Thor right now. But anyway, so he decides to erase his son's memory, and he casts him in the form of this lame meaning he's crippled, this lame doctor, Donald Blake, who was not a real person. Odin invented him, basically, as a human construct for Thor. So whatever memories he has of Donald Blake are not, they're artificial. He's really Thor, essentially, but he doesn't realize he's Thor. So, you know, he's a renowned surgeon, because also Odin wanted to become a healer to have empathy, right, for the wounded, the sick, those who are weaker, etc. And eventually over time, and the readers don't realize this until we get into these issues, that Donald Blake was never a real separate person, that Odin invented him, essentially, to teach Thor humility. So while the Donald Blake identity will continue for quite some time in the Thor book, into the Bronze Age, actually, it's Thor. It's always been Thor. And in these stories, Thor realizes I'm one and the same. Thor and Donald Blake are the same person, essentially. Donald Blake is just a human manifestation, so I could learn the humility that Odin wanted me to understand. Now, when you get into the Straczynski era, you read these stories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They have stories where Thor is talking to, like, a manifestation of Donald Blake, because it's like part of him, essentially. It's part of his memories. It's part of his psyche. It's part of who he is. But Donald Blake is not a separate living person. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? It's Thor, essentially. Did you want to add to that, Murd?
Well, yeah. There is one somewhat minor story from Roy Thomas's second run on the character in the mid-90s,
okay,
where he establishes that there actually was such a person as Donald Blake at one point. But yeah, Odin just kind of used him as a template for this construct that he stuck Thor into.
Okay.
So there was a Donald Blake, but he never became Thor.
Okay.
He was just used as the basis for this human shell that Odin assigned to Thor.
Well done. I counted on that. Thank you, Murd. I didn't know that. Now, again, if you go to the movie, they make that one-off reference to Jamie used to be with this guy named Donald Blake. She gives Thor his shirt. He says, yes, this shirt will suffice. And then they have him pretend to be Donald Blake when he tries to break into the S.H.I.E.L.D. facility. Yep. Steroids! Anyway, you know, that, if you don't know the history of Thor, you have no idea who they're talking about, essentially, because that's all gone now. I mean, the last we see of Donald Blake, as far as I can remember, is when Straczynski uses him as like a
sounding board.
Yes, exactly.
Talk,
a sounding board that Thor talks
there.
To, yeah. Essentially. Because it's his human side, basically. So
that's interesting, because I had not known that, and I didn't really think about it, but so, yeah, I've never seen Donald Blake, because I didn't read the Straczynski stuff. I just started up with the Jason Aaron stuff.
Because doesn't the Straczynski run that first issue start with Donald Blake, and then somehow
well,
I remember
issues,
him...
Thor is trying to... find all the Asgardians because they're trapped. Remember, Loki is a woman.
Right.
Essentially,
right.
They're great stories. They're all in these human forms. They don't remember who they are, and he's traveling around. And remember, Sif is trapped as an old woman, and she's dying essentially.
Yeah.
And he's traveling around trying to get them to remember who they are and so forth. The Straczynski run is I think is a classic.
Yeah.
And the art by Olivier Coipel on
is
breathtaking. So. But that's the in a nutshell, that's Donald Blake, essentially. Now, issue 160, and now Galactus. Shay, if you'd be so kind as to bring up that image. This is one of my favorite Silver Age Thor covers. And again, Galactus isn't just in the Fantastic Four, right? He's a cosmic entity. you know, part of the Marvel Universe, part of the fabric of the universe, essentially. And this involves Ego of the Living Planet, in issue 161, beings known as the Wanderers, who Thor, the Wanderers, and Ego actually all work together to drive Galactus away because he's going to consume more planets.
The Wanderers are survivors of the very first planet Galactus ever consumed, by the
Thank
way.
Thank you.
The planet Archaeopia.
And I just got a chill. Just got a jolt of electricity right up the spine. And Ego invites the Wanderers onto his planet, onto itself, I should say. And actually, when Byrne does the FF issue, I think he mentions I think Ego actually consumed the Wanderers eventually. But this is classic cosmic Kirby, just in grand epic style. I can't emphasize how magnificent these issues are just from a visual standpoint. I mean, they are beautiful. And I can only imagine what the original art goes for these stories.
Yes, if you can find it.
Yeah, exactly. Issue 162, 163, Lee continues with the whole notion of Galactus, where Odin is pondering the origin. Like, where does Galactus come from? What is Galactus? And they're going to pick that thread up for a little bit. Murd, I think you'd be interested in issue 165. Him!
Ah, yes. Go ahead, sir. Saga of Adam Warlock.
Yes, continue.
Yes, another case of, science meeting mythology here. Yes. It's because Him was the perfect human being designed by a group of human scientists calling themselves the Enclave. And
this goes back to Fantastic Four.
Exactly, yeah. Yes. And so they created this golden-skinned humanoid known only as Him. And he was kind of childlike, shall we say, naive as to the ways of the world and of the cosmos beyond it. And this is kind of another stage in his gradual evolution into Adam, the messianic figure that would be Adam Warlock.
Which, of course, Starlin picks up on and runs with.
Oh, yes. Well, Roy Thomas before that.
That's true, yes. He started the Warlock series. Yeah.
Right. But at this point, he's not even Warlock yet. He's still the innocent childlike Him, and he's venturing beyond his native world for the first time into space, and he tries to mate with Sif.
Yes. And this plunges Thor into what's known as the warrior madness, because he's trying to save Sif, which of course he does. And to punish him for succumbing to the warrior madness, Odin tells Thor, your punishment is to go out to the universe and find the secret of Galactus. So I want you to travel out into the distant, into space, and find out what Galactus's origin, because in previous issues, Odin was pondering what is the origin of Galactus. So Odin is concerned about, what can I do to protect Asgard and the Nine Realms and Earth if Galactus returns, essentially. So Thor travels out there, issues 168 to 169, the awesome answer. And Lee and Kirby give the origin of Galactus. Now, I should mention John Byrne later modified this origin. In the original version, he's still from the planet Ta, but he comes from the planet because everybody on the planet Ta is dying from a plague. And some survivors rocket away from it, and eventually their ship is destroyed, but Galactus is consumed by this energy, which makes him into Galactus. Now, when Byrne takes over in the FF, he establishes that Galactus was from a civilization prior to the Big Bang, and that, like, it's, I think it's dying of entropy or something like that. The last survivors of the civilization, his name is Galen, and he goes out into space, and I think he's consumed by the Big Bang, if I remember correctly. Right, and he's...
Not consumed exactly, but he's a cosmic egg forms around him. So
yes.
he gestates in the birth of the big... the birth of the new universe.
And it therefore becomes part of the order of things of this new universe. Like, Galactus is part of the natural order of this new universe.
Right.
So Lee and Kirby sort of start that story. Byrne then takes it further, and he... I think he does a book, The Origin of Galactus, if I remember correctly, John Byrne. But he runs with it in more detail. But it starts here in these issues. But again, it's Kirby doing Galactus. It's just awe-inspiring, all right, these images. Now, again, always trying to be topical. Issue 171, there's a civil rights activist named Pedro Luis Lopez who was shot. And there's a concern about there'll be massive riots if he dies. He may have been an analog for Martin Luther King Jr. And Blake, of course, has to perform surgery to save this important civil rights leader's life. Again, Marvel always trying to make the story seem relevant, seem like there's something that people could, that this could be in our world, essentially. 172, Jane Foster appears, but now she's with another doctor, she's in another relationship, so she and Thor are not romantically joined at this point. Issue 173, Ulrich returns, and is this a favorite of yours, more the Circus of Crime?
Sure.
The ringmaster, right?
Mm-hmm. The ringmaster and his usual gang of criminal performers who he hypnotizes the crowd, and then the performers rob them while they're entranced.
Yeah. he appeared in other Marvel titles.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing Spider-Man,
all over
I want to say.
He's encountered the Hulk a bunch of times.
So he also pops up in Thor a couple times again, just showing how no Marvel character had a sole claim on any one villain. They could appear anywhere, essentially. And that's part of the fun. Issues 175 to 177, you have a massive dynamic between Surtur, Loki. They also have the concept of the Odin sleep. Remember what that is, Murd?
Mm-hmm. It's when Odin periodically must go into sort of a comatose regenerative state in order to recoup his Odin power, and during which time he's kind of vulnerable, and the realm can be run into the ground by, well, people like Loki, who might try to seize power while he's napping.
And that happens several times.
Yeah.
And, in fact, in the Thor movie, they have him in the Odin sleep.
Yeah.
So,
do they ever mention if Odin needs the Odin sleep, did his father and grandfather have something similar? Or is Odin the only one that needs the Odin sleep?
Yeah, I think Odin, answer that. He's something a little different from what his ancestors had been. I don't think either of them were really all fathers, per se. Think about how he acquired the powers of his brothers, Vili and Ve, and that allowed him to become something more than any other Asgardian ruler before him.
Okay. Good enough.
Well done, Murd. Now, issue 177 is a classic cover. I didn't send that to you, Shane, I should have. But another just famous Kirby pose when it comes to Thor. And, of course, Thor is issuing the clarion call for Asgard! Now, issue 178 is the first issue without Kirby. It's John Buscema penciling, which, of course, is no slouch either. And, that, again, the Abomination is Thor's opponent in that story.
Next best thing to Thor versus Hulk.
Exactly. And then issue 179 is the final Lee Kirby issue. It's 1970. Kirby's probably already left Marvel, I would imagine, by this point. And in it, Loki and Thor switch bodies, so Loki up to mischief again. Of course, that doesn't work out for him ultimately. But it's the last Kirby issue of Thor. And, of course, by this point, I'm sure because the publisher's got he's already left for DC, you know, by this point, and he's working on the New Gods and so forth. As we mentioned, he probably brought some of his Asgardian concepts, and my guess is he brought them over to the New Gods. Now, any questions before I touch upon a few final themes here?
Nope.
No, sir.
Nope.
Shane, would you go to the collage? Not the collage, the blacklight image, please.
Bazinga.
Now, in terms of multi... Murd, it's... God, it's so you.
Dude, my hands are huge. They can touch anything but themselves. Oh, wait.
Actually, can you read the...
It's a little bit too fuzzy.
The word balloon? Here. Let me try to read because it's fantastic. Hold on.
I can't get it. Let me...
I lie still and silent, strip my mind of earthly thoughts.
Oh, fantastic. So it's Donald Blake slumbering, and you, in his imagination, you see Thor and Asgard and the Bifrost, the Rainbow Bridge, in pure black light. These posters are so expensive, if you can even find them.
Really?
Oh,
yep.
Triple digits easily.
Really?
Yes. It's one of my holy grails. I want one of these posters. It's hard to even find them intact. So, well, I've seen some that are like kind of torn up, for example.
Well, were they kind of velvet, felty, or
just paper?
No, they're
just paper.
Okay. But they're really hard to find.
Huh.
I gave
and for a comic book shop owner to say that, they're very hard to find.
Yeah.
I know you've traveled the breadth and length of this great land looking for these.
Indeed, sir. And I've seen them on occasion, but I saw a Hulk one. It was like $150. I didn't have the money.
Yeah.
I did find some of the cards I gave one to Murd of Doctor Strange.
Right.
But I love them. But this is an example of multimedia Thor in the Silver Age. And, of course, the classic animated series. This is 66, I think. They did Thor, Submariner, Iron Man, and Captain America and the Hulk. You all know the Captain America theme song. When Captain America throws his mighty shield. All right. So Pants played the Thor theme before. They're a hoot. They even had an episode, I forgot if it's in Cap or Thor, where they had all the Avengers come together, actually. But it's the original art, just with sort of very crude stop-motion animation techniques, essentially.
Was that the same era where they used in the first Iron Man movie as his cell phone song was one of the old Iron Man
Tony
cartoons.
Stark. It's kind of a jazzy theme.
Something like
probably.
That.
Yeah, probably. Probably.
Go back for a second.
Please.
Just surfing eBay.
Please.
There is a mint Marvel Blacklight Thor poster for $600 going on there right now.
That's it. That's the poster. Gadzooks.
$600.
Yeah.
Wow.
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 Wow. All right, enough of this wow stuff.
Wow.
My friends, that's my humble best, the mighty Thor in the Silver Age.
No, nothing humble about it, my friend. It's
closing comments, reflections, or queries?
I learned some stuff.
I become more edumacated.
Several hoots for this episode.
Several hoots, okay. Several hoots.
I would also mention that I hope to return to Thor down the road with additional spotlights because
the
Thor comic has such a rich history. Just we talked about the Straczynski run, which is just one small part, really, of the whole character's history. I mean, when you get into the Bronze Age, Jerry Conway does scripting, Roy Thomas, you've got beautiful John Buscema artwork in a lot of the Bronze Age, for example. Simonson stuff in the 80s is, for some people, that is the definitive Thor. And I think Brian Deemer is a big fan of the Simonson Thor.
I have first two trades of that. I haven't read it yet.
I mean, that's tremendous stuff because he brings a lot of the Norse mythology into it as well. The Straczynski run is fantastic. And the stuff Jason Aaron's been doing for the past couple of years, I've been enjoying thoroughly.
Now, there was a lot of good stuff in here. I had no clue. I've never, unlike other spotlights that you've covered, I've never read any of these at all in any way, shape, or form.
All the Marvel Masterworks are out there in soft or hardcover with all these stories.
On a side note, I think if somebody wanted to take this kind of an episode to the next level and you were of age, a drinking game of anytime Chris says now would be and a half.
It is one of my favorite transitional words now, isn't it?
That's okay. It was. I wish I would have started counting. That would have been a little.
You got to be able to drive home, though, my friend.
Good little statistic.
Because I've had a lot of drinks.
Yeah.
Let me tell you.
You got to do this at home when you're listening to it.
Brethren, I've shot my bolt. As always, I thank you. It was an honor.
Thank you.
If there's nothing else from the gathered, all right, then we'll wrap it up. Look forward to more spotlights in the future, but don't hold us to a time. They're going to come out whenever you want them to come out. And this episode, once again, was brought to you by SuperheroStuff.com. You can go to for all of your
superhero stuff.
Visit us at ComicGeekSpeak.com. To send us an email, the address is ComicGeekSpeak@gmail.com. To leave a voicemail, the number is 267-702-6642. Stop by thecomicforums.vanillaforums.com. Follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook. Thank you to everyone who contributes to the episodes. We appreciate it. I think I heard recently a call for more Muddle the Merds in an episode I was listening to, so do that. And as always, we are uniting the world's mightiest heroes, one listener at a time.
Rainbow Bridge.